Where is everyone?
Good question.
Taking their time tonight.
Yeah. It's been 3 weeks, right? They're all out of that.
It's been 3 weeks. Heard from a few of them though, and Mike Flynn should be here.
Right.
It says 10 people. Let's go. At looking.
Hi, Chuck.
Hi. This one, Mike Flynn, there you go.
I'm going to 995-1261-5871.
Hope that wasn't your social security number.
No, bank account number.
Say that again, Dave.
Which has nothing in it.
There he is.
All right, can you hear me?
You can.
I figured you just didn't want me in.
Chuck, I was on my phone and now I switched to the computer, so I'm going to switch off from the computer. Phone, sorry.
All right.
I'm on my phone, so.
All right, Chuck, should we be letting some of these in?
Sure. Well, any more members? So it's just Lori Burke that we need for the first meeting. I don't have a script tonight, so we'll just start in.
Okay. Martha.
There it is. I did find it, Mike. If you want me to start out by reading that, start recording, and then we'll bring either everyone in or just Lori Burke, because she's the first agenda item.
I think we should just bring everybody. I mean, that's what we've been doing previously.
Sure.
Martha was in, and then she got disconnected, I think. But should I just should we just be mid and all and muting?
I think the muting's on, but I did notice that everyone started.
I did start muted.
You did?
Yeah. Evening, Martha.
Hello. And Nika is sideways again.
I thought it was just on my phone.
No.
I did watch the whole last meeting and you were that way.
All right. Am I?
I'm going to let the other people in check and then we'll get this going.
Sure.
At least you're like this, so. Hey.
That's better.
Good.
Oh, thanks, Martha.
All right, it's being 7:07. We'll welcome everybody to the August 12th, 2020 conservation meeting. It's been a few months of Zoom meetings here, so I think we've gotten into the groove a little bit, but we're going to start with Chuck has a little intro to go over how the process is going to work. Then we will introduce the commission members present, and we'll move on to the first agenda item. Chuck?
Sure. Hello, everyone. This is Chuck Tarone, the Reading Conservation Administrator, assisting with the governor's order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law and allowing to us to adhere to social distancing requirements during the COVID-19 crisis. This Town of Reading Conservation Commission is being held virtual via Zoom audio participation. Conservation commissioners, applicants, or their representatives, and the public. During this meeting, myself or the conservation chair will unmute commissioners, applicants, and representatives. During the conversation, the chair and the administration will be the only ones participating in sharing the video on the screen. These controls are in place to ensure the meeting is safe and effective at all times. I would like to confirm that all members present for tonight's meeting. Mike, would you like to run the roll call for the members?
Yeah, so I'll go through the roll call. If you could remember this order, this is how we're going to vote. So Michael Flynn, chair.
Anika Scanlon, vice chair.
Dave.
David Panette, member.
Carl.
Carl Ciccone, member.
John.
John Sullivan, member.
Martha
Moore, member.
Missing anybody?
Me, Scott Keith, member.
Scott Keith, yeah.
Hey.
Real quick.
All right.
It shows me as Henry Swanson. I've had this issue in the past. I don't know how to correct it.
Okay. Threw me off the name there. I didn't even see you.
Up in the upper right-hand corner of your picture, you click there and you should be able to do rename.
Yeah, I've done it. I've been able to do it in the past. It's not allowing me to do it now. At least I haven't been able to. I know what you're talking about, that function.
Right. There you go.
Nice.
All right. Did I miss any members? That may be here. Just so everybody's aware, if even our members, I think you guys have gotten the hang of this so far, but if you're on mute, you know, we've been muting people due to background noise in certain occasions. If you're on mute, you can always get our attention by raising your hand. There's the raise hand feature on the side, that brings you to the top, notifies Chuck and I to to make sure we get a comment. You can also wave. The items on the meeting for tonight are on the Conservation Division webpage, if you'd like to follow along. And, you know, as always, if there's something that you, that somebody from the public has seen here tonight and doesn't feel like they had a chance to comment, you know, they should feel free to email the conservation, the email at the conservation website. We'll start off with our first meeting. This is 105 Lila Lane. This is an RDA filed by Lori Burke under the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act for the construction of a walkway, driveway, entrance to the backyard, cement pad, native plantings along the fence, reinforce the existing pool wall and some additional structures along the pool. I believe this meeting started at the last meeting, and there were some updated site plans that we received. So I'll turn it over to the applicant. You can let us know what's changed and what this looks like. Chuck, do you have something before we get moving?
No, just to tell Lori that I'll put the screen up, and she can just start letting us know what's going on.
Okay, so I think I'm just going to we went over this plot plan before, but I kind of want to go over just some of the questions that were raised or concerns last time. And I've spent the last few weeks kind of working on with the landscape designer, a mason, architect, et cetera, just to get some answers and just put it all in one spot here on the plot plan. So why don't we just go start right in and go with the first thing is the deck. There's a picture of that where there's the current 16 by 18 size. And then there's the addition of the 14 by 20. And the 20 is going to go along the whole, all of the front. There's going to be a roof over the 16 by 18 portion with a screened in, all screened in on the sides. And then the other section, which is the 14 by 20, would be an open trellis, an open deck area. And it's laid out there on the plot plan. So the last time we talked about stairs, so that's the next piece of this. We had stairs originally going down from the trellis deck, as I call it, and we were talking about curving them. And then when speaking with the mason, we decided if we went straight out from the wall and did more of a natural stone rather than wooden stairs going down, that would give us the curve we wanted to sort of curve it back towards the house when it, on the bottom step would be closer to the house rather than coming straight down. And that's there with those circles. Yeah, Chuck, I think, yeah, thank you. Those are the circles. That's the rock wall. And I have a picture of that. Just sort of, there's a rock wall on the other side. It's just a, a picture of what they would look like. They're just the same as the stones that are there, but there'll be a larger size. And the stairs will extend out approximately 9 feet, maybe longer. It's hard to say with the natural stones. And it looks like it will land about 15 feet from the 35-foot no structure zone line. And that's on that chart. So we had... Yep, so that's according to the mason. So that's that, and that's our sort of the largest project in, that we're going through with now. So that's the first one. Should I stop for any questions, or you want me to keep going with all the other pieces? How do you want me to do it, Chuck?
I think you should just continue and...
Okay. Okay. So another question that came up last time was the rain management system, and I don't know if you can tell from the picture I sent, but it's going to be on the left side of the roof coming down. There will be a gutter system. The roof is a copper. Back where the roof is. You can't see me, but yes, exactly. That it will be going along that line, and that will be a gutter system. The other side will not have a gutter. It will just fall right off, and we're looking at a metal straight seamed roof type roof. That's that. The next one was walkway from the driveway to the door, which is the door under our house deck. That is just pervious pavers. In speaking with Mason, he said it would be a 3-foot wide walkway with gravel and sand under pervious pavers, stones. Next one is slab under the deck. That was a cement slab. That's the length of the deck, no longer. And what is in the current space is rock and crushed stone. It'll be a cement pad. The next one is the planting plan. Sorry. Yep. I did that after that. So that next one is a plant. Sorry. So now we're on G. Yep. Thank you. Here we go. E, F, G, planting plan. Okay. So planting plan was, I looked at, went to Russell's. There's a native plant specialist there and spoke about the plants that they recommended for my area based on the sun and the dirt. So we're thinking of doing 3 rings of plants. One is kind of circling the 14-inch tree. The other is circling the 10-inch tree, kind of semicircle. And then there's sort of a rock in between these two trees. There's like tons of roots and rocks. So we were just going to do a circle around the rock of native plants. And I listed the native plants that we were putting there. There are 30, basically 30 of them that make these circle type things. And then to the right, kind of to the right of behind the peystone area, sort of between the peystone and the deck. Yeah, those three. We propose to put 3 blueberry shrubs there. And I did sort of a printout, you know, just kind of very sketch-like thing, but that's of that on the next 2 pages. So that's sort of how it's going to look there with the plants around it. Yep. And then the next one is the... Yep, and that's blueberry shrubs, again, next to the rocks behind the peystone. And then the last one is the pool deck, and that is 3-foot border around the pool deck that's existing now. Yep, right there, to the there's a patio there, and to do a 3-foot wide natural stone border on the top, bottom, and left side, and to leave the right side without the border. And the materials we're looking at were limestone pavers or a natural stone around there. And those, I think that's it.
All right, thank you. I guess I'll start with Carl. Maybe, do you know, are you familiar with the plantings that are proposed around the trees? Do you know, or?
Yeah,
or,
so there's, most are perennial, native perennial. There's some Joe Pye weed and I think it's aster or blue star. So yeah, I mean, yep, and then we all know blueberry shrubs, like a low, I think that's a low bush or high bush. So
yes,
yeah, I mean those are Mike, sorry I wasn't at the other meeting, but were there any trees to be taken down or
no?
This is just sort of a plus of added planting, in other words.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah. So those are yeah, those are nice. Mostly perennial, but a few shrubs. Yep.
So I'll put it up. Any comments, other comments from the commission here?
I think it's going to look pretty nice.
Thank you. I hope so.
An invitation after it's all done.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely. It's perfect. It's outdoor. It's an outdoor space with, you know, it's perfect for COVID.
I was wondering where the gutter is going to drain to that's on the left side of the roof.
It's going to drain into the back.
And will there be like crushed stone underneath or just a
there, spout yes.
runoff on the lawn?
So there's crushed stone now existing from the deck from when that was built in 2017.
Okay.
We had talked about also doing a rain chain and a barrel too, but we haven't gotten that far. We've just met with the structural engineer.
I have, sorry, let me raise my...
Go ahead, Carl.
Sorry. So the fieldstone steps, I was just reading the description. So those will just be sort of set on gravel as well? There's not going to be any footing for that, is there, or anything?
No, he was going to see how they are in the picture.
Yep.
They're going to be on top of each other. He's doing it the same way. There's an existing wall with rocks now, and he's going to try to just kind of come from that wall and curve these steps naturally like he did. The person who did it was Jim Hayes, and he did those stairs that I showed a picture of. But they're going to be larger than that.
I think I had seen that. And then he'll just use some other smaller boulders to cheek up against if he needs to the curve I read. So again, just sort of on grade, right? And there's nothing more than that.
Yeah, it starts from 3.5 feet, and he's going to come down from 3.5 feet down. So I think he told me the stones will be 18 inches depth by 6 inches by height by 3 feet wide.
Okay. Yeah.
That's what he's thinking. And he'll use other stones to support the curve. Is that what you're asking about, supporting that curve on the side?
Yeah.
He said he will use the stones that are there from the wall to support the curve.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Where needed, yeah.
All right, any other comments from the commission? Chuck, do you have any items?
At the last meeting, we had asked for a number of changes and a number of clarifications, and I see that they all have been represented. And as Lori said, this project, even with everything mentioned, which is a lot, ends up being on existing lawn or pea stone and outside the 35-foot no structure zone. So this updated plan is, I'm satisfied.
I would agree. I mean, I think it's a great presentation, particularly for an RDA that we typically get. So I appreciate you walking us through it. I'll open it up are there any comments from the public, please feel free to raise your hand. Seeing none. All right. I guess I'd open it up. Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to close the hearing.
Second.
All those in favor? Mike Flynn in favor? Anika?
Anika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
O'Keefe in favor.
All right. And do I your motion associated with the RDA?
I move we issue a negative determination with conditions.
Second.
Okay.
Just to be clear, what were the conditions, Anika?
Just the new additional information provided for this meeting and all the clarifications since the last.
All right, excellent. Mike Flynn in favor?
Anika Scanlon in favor?
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl?
In favor. Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
O'Keefe in favor.
Great. All right, Lori. Thank you very much. So
what does that mean?
So negative determination means that we've determined that you do not have to file for a notice of intent. The Chuck, she can begin at risk, or how long does the process take?
Yeah, so there's a 10-day appeal period, and you know, there's a lot of things happening here, but with these RDAs, it's I don't know if it usually says that you can start if you want at your own risk, but the actual time should be 10 days from now, which would be 10 business days. And that will get you through the appeal, and you'll be have no issues with any neighbors. If someone appeals, then you have to stop. And if DEP gets involved, you have to put everything, you're likely to have to put everything.
So we need to we were going to go to the building inspector. Is that okay to go forward with that, with the plans?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
And that would be great use of that time, that 10 days. So
okay, so we can go forward with that and the structural engineer, and that's all safe to do, and we have 10 days. There's an appeal. And how does the appeal work?
It gives all the abutters an opportunity to say that they feel like something wasn't represented, or they weren't able to communicate at the Zoom meeting, which has become common. And then DEP kind of looks at it again. The problem with that is they're not doing any, they're not looking at any, you know, orders or RDAs until like 45 days after the COVID-19 crisis is over. So it would really be a long time.
Yeah.
So it doesn't seem like it's a project that you and the abutters came in and had a problem with, but
right.
And I would just start the process with the building inspector and go from there.
Okay, that's great.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, Lori.
Have a good night.
All right, it being at least 7:15, we'll move on to the next item on the agenda. Chuck, is this one is 53 Arcadia Ave, that is before us? We documented yesterday, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we'll open the public hearing for RDA for Eric Hagstrom for 53 Arcadia Ave. This is minor grading within the existing maintained lawn area, remove two dead trees, one 14-inch hemlock, 14-inch white pine in the rear, and remove a cluster of spruce trees. The applicant's proposing a small expansion of their existing driveway and landscape barrier around the house. All of the work is within the riverfront area, and portions of the work is within the 100-foot buffer zone. File number RDA 2020-4. So we received some updated plans in response to the last meeting on July 22nd. I don't know if the commission's had a chance to review them, but we'll allow the applicant to just go over what changes have been made and what was submitted. Greg, go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. For the record, Greg Hockmuth from Williams and Sporadges, representing the applicant, Eric Hagstrom, for the RDA filed for 53 Arcadia. This is the one we had also submitted two COC requests that we're not asking the commission to act on at this point in time. The main reason being there's still a few items on this property that have to be buttoned up before we can request the certificates of compliance. And we've added those items to this RDA. So the hope is to get approval for the project that's before you, which will essentially kill two birds with one stone. We'll be able to button up the outstanding items and hopefully come back to the commission once everything's stabilized and green with the COC requests. But just to go over some of the changes that were made since the last meeting, We mentioned that at the last hearing that the one of the prior orders talked about a swale that needed to be created just to ensure that water didn't shed onto the abutting property, or at least most of the water. So what we've done is we've added a little swale to the right behind the house of the 82 contour. And if you look at the existing grades, it should sheet flow down, hit that swale, and then eventually flow back down towards the river as it always did before. So it's a subtle swale. It won't look like an intermittent stream or anything, but it's just a little blip in the grading on the 82 finish contour. We added the three-inch caliper sugar maples that were required from one of the prior orders as well. You can see one of them is to the right of the front of the proposed driveway expansion. The other is to the left front corner of the house. And the third is just above that on the way back to the resource area. So those three sugar maples were a requirement of one of the prior orders. So those have to go in before we can request a COC. We weren't proposing any additional plantings at the last meeting, but we've had a chance to go back to talk to our clients, and they're more than willing to put in a couple more trees to help compensate for the trees that they want to take down in the rear of the property. There's a dead white pine, a dead ash, and then a 14-inch white pine and a 14-inch hemlock that are not dead. So in looking at the backyard, it's slightly thinner on the left. So it just made sense to try to put the new proposed trees. We're proposing two-inch caliper red maples. And we're going to try to put those, if we can get approval, right next to the dead ash and right next to the dead pine that are proposed to be removed. I think they'll grow fine there. The woods are slightly thinner. There are still a ton of invasives back there. So maybe when these two trees go in, we can try to do just a initial swipe anyways of some of the invasives that are in that area and get them out of there. But other than that, nothing else on the plan has changed. I'd be happy to go over everything again if the commission would like me to.
Greg, what size trees are you proposing to plant in caliper?
So the three sugar maples will be 3-inch caliper, and the two new red maples would be 2-inch caliper.
Two?
Yep. And the applicant is aware of the tree policy, and he's more than willing to donate to the tree fund. That's something we didn't include in this RDA, but he understands it's something he's going to have to do. So it's really just fine-tuning grading. The bulk of the work is, you know, the driveway expansion out front there, and then the tree removal. And if it makes sense to leave the stumps, he's happy to do so. Out back, I think the stumps out front in the front left corner would have to come out just to make room for that sugar maple.
Out of curiosity, and I apologize because I wasn't at the last meeting, so I don't know if this was discussed already, but as far as the trees goes, you mentioned, and I can see in here, the 13-inch dead white pine. So there's two dead that you're proposing to plant next to right now. I haven't been able to do a site visit, so I apologize, but have we gone out? Did we see that those are? Have we seen that those are dead?
I was out there.
This is a question for the commission more than the applicant. Sorry.
I do have photos that I can try to pull up if that's helpful. I'm not an arborist, but I think anybody can look at those two and clearly see that they're goners. Okay.
Dave, I think you were saying something.
I was out there. I saw the trees. Okay. All the trees that were proposed to be cut And I was in agreement on the trees to be cut.
Okay. And I just have, I guess, a question. So you're proposing to put this, the silt sock, the mulch sock, in the back, you know, kind of near the 35-foot zone. It crosses at one point, basically matches the tree line. There's an existing silt fence out there, is that correct?
Yeah, so what happened was that there's two outstanding orders. Mm-hmm. One of them was issued a while ago for some clearing and some fill that was brought in. That was mitigated, all the plantings were put in. And then they came through not too long after with another notice of intent for an addition. The addition was built, but whoever did the site work did a horrible job grading. And they just left this awkward berm in the backyard. It grades off very abruptly and then flattens out again, almost like a terrace. So yep. Our idea was, and the bulkhead is somewhat exposed. It's really odd. So what Eric would like us to do is to try to get permission just to, you know, tighten up that grading, feather it out a little bit, just so it looks more uniform. And at the same time, fill in around the bulkhead and just minor tweaks here and there. What we tried to do is just run the erosion controls along the existing edge of woods, edge of lawn, because the reality is when they loam the newly graded areas, it would just make sense to dust the other areas with loam at the same time and get a uniform lawn. So you're not having a patchy section that doesn't look like the rest of it.
Yeah, okay.
But there's no intent to raise the grade there at all. You know, if they needed to just backblade what was there, they could do that too. I just don't know what the material below it looks like. They may need to dust it with a little bit of loam.
All right. Any other comments from the commission? Questions? Dave, when you were out there, you indicated you were okay with the trees. I guess my question it was really, do you agree that the two were dead, and then there's the two 14 hemlock and 14 white pine? Those are in relatively good condition.
Actually, they're not. There's some dead growth on the top of both of the trees. They're also pretty gnarly too. They're not like real straight trees.
Yeah, they're kind of leaning out.
They're leaning, and they're also, both of them have V crotches in them too. It's not a good situation.
Okay. Is there any other comments?
This is Anika Scanlon. I just have one question to the applicant. The swale that's designed there in the grading on the 82-foot contour line, what was the original proposed swale? Can you sort of explain that a little bit more? Because right now when I see that contour, I think to myself, well, that's only going to affect a very localized area of runoff.
Right.
So I just wanted you to go into that a little bit more.
So I think the fear was, I read through the findings, and it sounded like there was a neighbor at the time that was concerned about some runoff. And I think it was a neighbor to the right. I don't believe that fear is there any longer. There's a low point, there's an 80. A small isolated 80 contour right above where Chuck just was. The lot was always sloped towards the river. And I think the fear was when they dug the foundation hole for the addition that they were going to somehow direct more stormwater onto abutting properties. The reality is that probably wouldn't happen even without a swale. But it sounds like the commission at that time, to appease the abutter, said, okay, create some type of a swale that will direct the water, or most most of the water away from the neighbor's parcel. So that's really what we did. I mean, there's one essentially there now. We just super exaggerated it there to try to capture some more of the sheet flow that's coming off the back roof of the house. There are no gutters. There's just a drip edge. You can see where it says stone right behind the house. So during an average storm event, a good chunk of that probably infiltrates. But if we have a larger than average storm event, the swale should help capture some of that and get it back towards the river.
Are the contours on the plan that you most recently submitted, are those realistic, up-to-date, recent contours?
Yes, we did a brand new existing conditions plan out here. We sent the survey crew out. So what you see reflects the current as-built conditions.
Because I do see close to the right hand property line, I already do see a certain amount of, steep swale drainage in between the two properties, although I can't see the contours on the number 43 parcel.
So it does go up. It does rise up after that lot line. So there is a bit of a valley between the two lots. And you're right.
I mean, that's the swale more than the modified contour at 82.
I would agree.
Okay.
Yep. It just wasn't clear if that was, we didn't have any of the prior plans. We were just basing it off the findings. And Fran did a great job writing her findings. They were very detailed, very thorough. But without that plan, we were somewhat flying blind here.
Okay, I understand. No other questions.
I have a question about the trees.
Go ahead, Martha.
The three maples in the front are left over from the previous order of conditions. And the two red maples being planted in the back are replacing the hemlock and the white pine. But we're taking out five spruces in a clump in the front corner. And there are some trees going into the proposed landscaping in the list on the landscaping. It looked like a dogwood and something else. So, has anybody done the math of exactly how many trees they're talking about needing to donate to the tree fund?
Right. So that cluster of spruce trees sounds worse than it is. Those are not the best specimens. So the idea would be to get rid of those and put in a healthy sugar maple that should do really well in that corner. And I still feel the same way as I did at the last meeting. One healthy sugar maple, I think, would offset any impact by removing those seven spruce trees when coupled up with the landscape bed species that we show on the plan that will all be planted around the front of the house. It's a pretty good mix of natives there. And as you mentioned, there is a river birch, there is a dogwood. They don't get too large, but there's also some other berry producing shrubs and some asters and other herbaceous species.
So you really think you don't need to donate to the tree fund then?
Oh no, the client's well aware that he does. And he's more than willing to do that. I just think trying to crowd any more trees around this house just doesn't make sense. It gets to a point where you're just, too many trees isn't always a good thing. And you look at a sugar maple growing in the middle of a cemetery, those are some of the best trees when they're not competing. So I do getting rid of some of the competition there, putting in a sugar maple, it should thrive and really do well.
And on the border with number 43, there looks like there's about eight trees there existing, and those aren't going anywhere. Those are all still going to be there.
Those are all going to be there, and those are good looking spruce trees that are doing really, really well. And what you can't see is that back right corner of the lot where it's kind of shaped like a triangle. There's probably about seven river birch that were planted in there and a half dozen willows. It just shows this edge of woods, but there's some good trees in that back corner as well. We just didn't locate all of them and show them on the plan.
Right. Yeah, I went out and did a site visit, and I did see that there's a lot of trees in the back there. There are some invasive species as well.
And granted, those trees were put in because the area was cleared, but they're in and they are doing well.
So in line with that, and I, this is now got me a little confused. So the seven spruce that you've got to be taken away, were those part of the old order of conditions? Was that proposed under that?
No, those, it's actually three, there's five out front in that corner.
Okay.
It looks like four, an five. Area where somebody attempted to do their own landscaping design. They put in some spruce trees and they put in some other shrub species and then just never maintained anything. And they were way too crowded. They grew really thin. You can see right through all the spruce trees that are there. They're you're not your typical spruce.
Yeah.
I think I have some photos of those too.
You can see it from the street view. Too.
Yeah, okay.
Carl, I guess, does that planting make sense to you? You know, I think that, I would agree with Greg's statement. I mean, ultimately, we want to plant smart, not necessarily overplant.
Yeah. I was trying to follow along with the additions and subtractions, and the red maples will surely do well, and I'm on the street view as well. I do think that we would probably all agree that a quality planting and trees that are going to survive and provide a canopy and habitat are better than just simply having the quantity. So I do think that seems to be the right strategy.
John or Scott, do you guys have any questions or comments?
No, not for me.
So, Chuck, do you have any items? I mean, I think there's a little math to be done here, but I wanted to see if there's any other items that are sitting out there.
I'll up on a couple of the commissioners' questions. First off, the contour, it looks like the existing contours around the bulkhead are for somewhat, and I see one contour line. Is that going to straighten out the situation with the bulkhead? Because it looks like it's raised up and it needs grading around.
Yeah, those, we don't show any finish grades over there. It's probably a half foot to a foot. And we were showing, 1 foot contours, it probably just fell between. But we do need about a half foot of fill around that bulkhead, at least on the wetland side.
Okay, it's just, it looked like it needed some fill in that area. And then about the trees in the back, between the 35 foot and the edge of the wetland area, is there room to, instead of donate to the Shade Tree Fund, to do some more planting in that area because it is so close to the edge of the wetland and it's in the first 100 foot of the riverfront?
So, I'd love to say yes, and you can always plant anywhere. It's just so overrun with invasives in there. I think it's going to be a struggle to get them to outcompete one another. It is pretty dense with vegetation. I think a good chunk of it though is invasive, but there are a lot of mature trees in there. It's not a thin buffer by any means. You can't see the river. from the backyard. I imagine you can in the fall. But it's pretty green back there.
So the shade tree fund and the tree guidance policy ask for one-to-one replacement. I didn't go through the math, and I think I heard a couple of commissioners wondering where we're at with what you're planting and what's owed. Do you have a number on that? And I think it would have to include the, are you saying seven spruce? Yeah, I wrote that down. Seven spruce.
There's five spruce.
I think I heard seven at one point, and then I heard five, so.
Yeah, there's five spruce. So out back, you know, for the two healthy trees, or two trees that aren't completely dead, we're proposing two new trees. The two dead trees don't require one-to-one replication. Is that correct?
It is.
Okay. Correct. Then we just be down to the five spruce trees out front. We can't count the three sugar maples because those are supposed to be put in per the prior order. So I think that we're down to the five spruce. And with that said, you know, one of them 6 inch, one of them 7 inch. Is there a cap? Do the trees have to be a certain size?
6 inch.
Okay. So all of these would qualify. So it looks like five trees. I suppose we could subtract one for the river birch. But I think that's it. You know, I don't think we can count the dogwood unless the commission really wants to be generous. But it looks like four spruce.
And you're putting in nine shrubs.
That's right. Do shrubs count?
Yes.
So there's one, two at five foot tall would equal one tree. And then if they were smaller than that, it would be three. So you may have made it, as long as they're all native.
They are all native. And if we didn't make it, we can certainly add another dogwood or a couple more clethra. I think we could space them out so they're not crowded.
So do we show where those shrubs are going in?
So we show proposed landscaping, and we show a generic amoeba around the front left corner of the house. That's the proposed bed that we were hoping to put the bulk of these plantings in.
Mm-hmm.
And then between the paver walk and the corner of the garage, there'd also be some plantings proposed in that little area.
I'm sorry, I miscounted. It's seven shrubs and a dogwood and a river birch are on the list. I added all of them together to make nine.
I don't know that the ink barrier is going to get over 5 feet.
No.
Unless something went horribly wrong. So it looks like we will have to make a donation to the fund, which the client's prepared to do.
Yeah, I think that's why I was asking to look in the back by the 35-foot line, but there's no other opportunity. And I maybe Dave and Martha could speak to this better. Both of them have been out there recently.
I would say that you'd be able to plant another tree where it says 35-foot no build zone in the backyard. Right there.
Throw another red maple there?
I think you'd be able to be honest with you.
Or I was thinking in the area that kind of bows out further, you could put a few high bush blueberries, like, yeah, where that red mark is. If you put a few high bush blueberries in the front and tried to keep the invasives away from them, that's another option.
The only problem is there's not a ton of lawn here. And, you know, I think we're rapidly losing space. I think the applicant would rather propose something within the existing wooded area or another corner or towards the lot lines.
Is that 35-foot area where I have the cursor right now qualify for what your definition was of a plantable area? Or
yeah.
is it open lawn?
No.
It looks like it's in the tree row, so I'm...
It is in the tree row.
Yep, I think that would be a spot that we could put a tree.
Okay. That seems to be real close. I mean, I guess we could run the numbers just to make sure. But I think with that additional tree being added...
That's, you know, based on what I heard for numbers, I think with that additional tree being added, and if that had to turn into shrubs, if, you know, ultimately, you know, you get out there and you feel like there's not space, I think that, you know, the something you could have the conversation with Chuck and just kind of coordinate that. But I like the idea of trying to provide some more planting in that zone. I know most of the ones that we're taking away, the five spruce, are, you know, up in the front of the yard and away from our 35 and 25 and really outside the 100-foot zone. But ultimately, you know, because it's the riverfront, we want to make sure we're trying to protect that area as best we can.
Understood.
Okay. I'll open it up to the public. Are there any comments from the public? Raise your hand. Not seeing any. Any questions or other items from the commission at this point? And if not, do I hear a motion?
So this motion would have to be approval to amend the current NOI, correct? We're adding to the current NOI.
This is actually a new, we weren't able to because it expired, so we had to file a new RDA application.
Okay, so. So we would have to.
So this is an RDA, right? So what we could do is
determination of the RDA, and then
with condition that they meet the requirements of the open orders, is if we wanted to do, you know, if you wanted to add condition.
Because we have two certificates of compliance that are open, and some things that still haven't been finished from the old order of conditions, and then we have a new one. So I thought from what the LSP said in the beginning of it, that they were just adding that to what was incomplete from the old order. But that's not the case. It's a brand new order. Is that true?
It's a brand new RDA application. And what we've done is we've incorporated the outstanding items that were detailed in the prior orders, so that if this RDA is approved, we'll get permission to work within your jurisdiction again to button those items up. And at the same time, do a few other things around the house.
And Dave, one thing needs to be clarified is that these old orders are expired. So no work can happen under those orders. So this RDA should get some new work that they want on their property. And you've been there, you understand what's needed.
Yep.
And then help clean up those two RDAs. So that's not in front of those two certificates of compliance, which are not in front of us right now. But I suspect once this work is done, they'll come back and say they've met all the steps needed.
So at this point, the motion would be that we would make a motion for a positive determination of RDA, correct?
A negative determination.
Negative.
Then talk about some conditions.
Okay.
And just incorporate the new work description and the maple tree. So it was additional sugar maple or red maple in the back. I can't remember which one it was.
Red maple.
Okay.
So I make a motion to for a negative determination at 53 Arcady Rev.
Second.
Michael Flynn in favor.
Anika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
Scott. He's there. I think I just heard him.
So at this point, we have to make a motion to issue new order of conditions?
No.
Nope.
No?
Nope. There's, those aren't in front of us.
All right.
So. All right. Thank you, Greg.
Thank you very much. We'll, once everything's done and stabilized, we'll be re-requesting those certificates of compliance.
Great.
Have a good night. Thanks.
Yep. Thank you. We'll thank you, Eric.
Thank you, Mr. Hagstrom.
Thank you.
All right. Move on to the next item on the agenda. This is opening of a public hearing for notice of intent for Zero South Street, filed by the Town of Reading Engineering Division under Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, and the Reading Wetland Protection Bylaw, Section 7.1. The applicant's proposing to replace an existing aging pump station at Sturgis Park, located within an existing parking lot in the southeast corner of the park area. This includes new subsurface water pumping station of the same pumping capacity. Work will include installing backup generator. All work is within the 200-foot riverfront area, the buffer zone to the wetland. And just a reminder that any documents on this project, if you'd like to follow along, are available on the Conservation Division webpage. With that, I will turn it over to the applicant. I believe I saw Alex here. Oh, you already unmuted him, Chuck.
I'm trying to unmute him.
Alex, is there anybody else we should be unmuting?
Yeah, I have Jane coming on if she wants to be unmuted. And
it'll just be, I'll give a brief description of the project and I'll let Maggie take over. She's got more of the information on the conservation side of it.
So we have everyone. Alex.
Yeah.
We have everyone.
Maggie's unmuted. Should be good. Yep.
Great. Okay. Let me bring it. Do you want me to bring up the PowerPoint?
Yes, please.
Yeah, that'd be great. So yeah, this is Alex Rizicki, senior civil engineer with the Town of Reading, working with Ryan Percival, town engineer, who's not here this week, but thank you all for your time anyway. So we're working with CDM Smith to replace the existing Sturgis Park wastewater pump station at the intersection of Pine Ridge and South Street. The existing station there now is about 65 years old and it handles a large portion of the capacity down. We did a similar installation at Charles Street last year. I don't know if any of you have been down that way, but it'll end up looking pretty much the same thing if you happen to pass by that area. So, yes, Chuck, we could start with the presentation.
Oops. Where do you want to be?
Next.
Third slide.
Computer is a little bit touchy.
Yeah, that's fine. Sure.
Okay.
So, as you guys are probably aware, last time you were at this site, we replaced the existing head wall at that culvert that had been in disrepair, that helped stabilize the brook and allow for the skating ponds to be flooded each winter. So you're kind of looking at that, those skating ponds in the background, and the resource area would be behind the can that's got the vines growing over it inside that fence. That's the station itself, about 15 feet underground. And then the two manholes there would be the wet wells that go into the station. From that station there, it crosses the river, or I guess we'll call it the tributary or the stream. But basically, as I said, that station is about 65 years old. It handles flow from 530 properties, 0.75 MGD. one of our bigger stations in town, one of our older stations in town at this point. It's in the parking lot, and work would be within the 200-foot and even the 100-foot and even closer, which Maggie will get into. You can go to the next slide. And, yep.
There you go.
So, basically, underlaid, the gray area is essentially the existing layout of the parking lot. The dark gray line is the underground existing station. It's going to be moving further away from the resource area, ultimately. So the new wet well is going to be inside, basically in the same spot. We're going to have to take the old one out to put the new one in. The new one will have three pumps instead of the two that are there now for redundancy. And we're going to have a meter vault at the edge of the pavement that you see kind of near the top of the drawing there. And then we're going to have to run a force main to connect to the existing flow, to the existing system, which then, as I said earlier, crosses across the river. So most of the work will be pretty self-contained in the parking lot. But if you look near where it says electrical cabinet, and that Y, we are getting pretty close to the new head wall that we put up last year. Yeah, right north of there. Yeah, so that connection right there to the up one more. You could see the discharge line coming in connects to the old line. Yeah, right there. Yeah, so that's the closest we'll be getting. There's no disturbance of the bank itself. That area is obviously behind a concrete head wall. And everything on site will be self-contained. And we can get into some of the details about the construction after Maggie speaks, if you guys have questions. And I'll turn it over to her.
Okay. Can you close this? Well, my name is Magdalena Lofter. I'm the wetland scientist with CDM Smith. Back in March, I went out to the site and did the delineation for research areas. If you want to go to the next slide.
I'm Maggie, not here.
There?
Yeah.
Yeah, waiting for the next slide.
Oh, sure.
All right, so that's the existing condition. So the resource areas are the inland bank. There's no bordering vegetated wetland on the north side of South Street. So we have the bank, the 100 foot, the 25 foot, the 35 foot, and the entire side is going to be. For the next slide. So this is just a photograph that shows the existing pump station and what Alex was talking about, the connection that we have to make to the existing force main will be very close to that retaining wall and the new head wall that you can see to the left in that photograph. And so for erosion controls, we are proposing to use state compost logs around the limit of work and also around any stockpile piling areas of soils. Since this is a publicly bid project, we are requiring, we can't predict means and methods for the contractor, so we're asking him to submit a watering plan that will need to be reviewed and approved by the engineers and as well as the Conservation Commission. And where the stormwater from this site just, it's just cheap flow basically, or into the drainage in South Street. So we're proposing catch basins in the public catch basins.
So I'm getting a very garbled discussion. So not sure if anyone else is having a hard time hearing this or it's just me.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
It might be my internet connection.
Did you call in?
No, I'm on the video. I mean, on the. You want me to? I can call in.
This sounds a lot better.
It does now?
Yeah, that's a lot clearer for me at least.
Do you want me to go over this slide again?
Sure.
Okay. So this slide shows where the connection will be made. It shows the existing pump station and also the connection that will be made to the existing force main that Alex mentioned. How this is where we're going to be working very close to the retaining wall for the at the stream bank. Can you hear me okay, or is it still a bad connection?
It seems you got a lot of background noise, but I could hear you. I don't know about others.
Okay. All right, so then you want to go to the next slide? So this shows the proposed site plan. And as far as the, since it's an underground wastewater pumping station, the only above ground structures will be the electrical panel, which will be placed on a cast in place concrete pad, and then there'll be an emergency backup generator, a natural gas backup generator, which will also be placed on a cast in place concrete pad. And you can see that to the left on this site plan. And then the other above ground new structure will be the access manhole into the vault itself. And shown in the sort of green color would be the disturbed area for the construction of the new pump station, which will be restored with reinforced turf. And then the gray area is the existing parking lot, and we're actually reducing impervious area. So we're converting some of that parking lot to lawn. So there's an overall net decrease of 400 of impervious area. The parking lot will also get new granite curbing and full depth parking. So can you hear me, or is this still a bad connection?
It's a little bit better. It's still not great. But that's okay. Keep on going.
All right. So next slide. So this is a site rendering, and I should have mentioned that we are taking down three pine trees, and we are replacing those with three American basswood, so the American linden. 2-inch calipers. So the existing trees are coming down there, like on the north side of the station. And around the new emergency generator, we'll put up a 7-foot stockade, wooden stockade fence. So this will look very similar to the Charles Street station that Alex mentioned. That was years ago. And there'll also be like plantings. As this, you know, screening around that stockade. And you want to go to the next slide? This is just a summary of like the the temporary alterations. This is about 3,230 square feet to the riverfront area and buffer zone. You got a net reduction of approximately 415 square feet of impervious area within the riverfront. And that's just another talks about the trees that I just mentioned. If you want to go to the next slide? Just a summary of the compliance with the performance standards of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act for working riverfront. This would be the 310/3/R-10585 riverfront is previously developed. We This will be an improvement over existing conditions, as Alex mentioned, that we will be putting the new station further away from the stream. Will reduce impervious area. It qualifies as a redevelopment project under the stormwater management standards. So we will reduce the runoff rate and there'll be additional recharge and infiltration into reducing the impervious area. There's no disturbance closer to the stream other than the temporary alteration for the connection to the existing force main. That's all we had. So questions, I guess?
All right. I'll start. I'll open up to the commission. I don't know if you guys had the opportunity to do a site visit. I was out there. Carl, I know you talked about getting out there.
Yeah, I was there.
Do you have any notes from the site visit or questions?
Preparing a question in my head, it was nice to hear the presentation. I sort of looked through the package as I kind of stood there. So I think I'm just trying to get my head around this proposed plan after listening to that and the temporary disturbance.
Alex, I'll just start with a quick question that I had as I was looking at this. Sure. So can you describe a little bit, or maybe I can answer as well, what the excavation area is going to look like, just from like a size standpoint and depth standpoint? Because you're taking out the existing one, correct?
Yeah, so that basically, and it depends on the groundwater situation. At Charles Street, we had a hole that was about 20 feet deep. This one's not as deep, and it'll basically encompass that entire parking lot. As you see it now, will be on the order of 10 to 15 feet deep. So that entire parking lot comes out, and then it's put back in further away, and we're not going to replace the entire parking lot. As Maggie alluded to, we're going to go with a more impervious route, but the excavation will be substantial. We have to get 15 feet away, and the contractor, it'll be up to the contractor if he's going to need pilings on the bank side. We did have to go that route on Charles Street because the soils were not holding up, but that'll be up to him kind of when he gets out there and gets in there. We want to do the work over the winter, January, and then it'll be a little drier and the soils will work a little better for us in that sense, but it is a large excavation to get a pump station out.
Yeah. So it's going to be essentially a mass excavation, not like targeted pieces. You're not going to remove the existing wet wells and then, trench line in, or you don't know, is that may be up to the contractor.
I wouldn't imagine so. Once he gets this thing shut off, he's going to dig as quick as he can and as fast as he can to get this out. The whole thing gets scrapped. We don't save anything. All the equipment gets trashed. It comes out as quick as it can and as fast as it can. We want to be in and out of here and move on.
And you had mentioned that the new pump will be in a new location. So you have to remove the old pump, right? Station?
Yeah.
And then what does that hole just gets filled in, basically?
Yeah, it'll get backfilled. He'll likely take, we have to do some soil sampling and pre-characterization on site, I believe, still. We may need to get rid of all the soil on site, unfortunately. In an ideal world, it would be stored on site and contained around some erosion controls, or it could be brought to our yard and brought back. But I believe the inclination was we will need to bring in new backfill and new material. So that existing station is sort of that, if you're looking at the diagonal line that cuts across kind of the picture there, the existing station is just to the left of that, those two circles that you see, if you move the cursor up a bit, that one, and the one to the right, that's the existing station, pretty much on the edge of the parking lot. So that one comes out and the new one goes to the left so that we don't have to quite wait as long. One's got to come out before the other goes in, but you just give yourself a little more room and we'll get further away from, give ourselves a little better working area if we get further away from the stream.
And then one more question. I looked through the package and I don't think I may have missed it. The utilities for the generator, where is that coming in from? Like the trench, is that just, I'm assuming, underground wiring and utilities?
I believe it's a diesel generator.
Oh, okay. Just
on
a pattern.
We had gone, I could get back to you on that. On Charles Street, we're able to use natural gas off the street, but I do believe this will be a diesel backup. Potentially because there's no gas. I can get back to you on the utilities for the generator.
Okay.
The generator is even further, his cursor is on the station itself now. If you go to the rendering or the other pictures of the plan, the generator is even further away from the station itself. So yeah, you can see it. The station is the white box in the middle of that plan, essentially. Yeah, that's the station. The generator's back near the corner and near the intersection even further.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't... I'm pretty sure it's a diesel, but like I said, I could supply that information to Chuck and get back to you if needed.
Okay.
The new head wall, the head wall that's out there, do you know what that is? And how do you imagine that connection to the force main is actually done? I don't remember really the head wall coming before us. It might have been when I was early on the commission, but it looked like it's like a block. It doesn't look like a, well, there's the head wall, but did you redo the walls on the side, the wing walls as well?
I don't have our direction on this map, but the right side, if you're looking at that picture, was in total disrepair. We had replaced that with a concrete block head wall, right where Chuck's looking there. And at that time, we didn't have the funds to replace the left side. So what we had done is we've taken the existing granite and concrete, the granite is what it was, and kind of reset them, reshape them, and mortar them up again. So they're much more sturdy than they were a year and a half ago. We had maybe thought about putting the concrete block there, but that connection is going to be pretty tight. Thankfully, that's not as deep as the station. I don't have the depth on that fourth main offhand, but he'll just have to. I imagine he would want to put a plate behind the wall and then be able to work within a safe trench in that sense. That work is no more than a day, maybe, a couple hours a day here or there. So that part of the portion is pretty quick. But that's as close as we get, really. And thankfully, it is kind of reinforced last year. Otherwise, we'd probably happen to do that over again. Or having to go in front of you to do that as part of this project.
Yep. Okay. And then ultimately, so that block wall or the granite block wall will be in between, the work and the stream.
Yeah, and that granite block wall is probably about, or the granite blocks are probably about 8 feet tall, at least. They're certainly over my head, maybe even closer to 10 feet. So I don't even think we would see the bottom of that. So we should be able to, that provides us a pretty good boundary so that we can't really get anywhere near the tributary itself.
Okay. Any other questions from the commission? John, do you have any questions? Martha? Where Martha went.
No questions.
Dave or Anika?
No, I don't have any questions. It looks pretty pro forma to me.
Okay, yeah, I just want to chime in that, you know, to me, from what I, excuse me, the hiccups, I'm sorry. I'm looking at the site utility plan. And it just looks like there's like all these pipes are going to be pretty deep and are in order to at least lay the pipes or repair or replace, install those pipes, there's going to be some, definitely going to be some dewatering needed. One of my questions was, you know, the proposed stations, excuse me, how deep do the excavations have to go in those areas?
I believe the existing station is about 12 feet deep, but I had a decision to make because of my work computer. I can either be on video or have my plans and my work computer on, and I decided that you guys would get a treat to the video call. So I believe it's on the order of 12 feet deep. When you talk about installing a concrete footing, we're probably looking at about 15. Knowing what we ran into at Charles Street, dewatering is obviously a concern, and he will be submitting a dewatering plan. On Charles Street, we actually ended up bringing in the sedimentation, essentially the shipping containers as a sedimentation settling chamber. That's something that if it comes to that and he can't control, we had tried the sediment bags and the discharge through the bags, and then the bags get replaced when after a certain amount of time or they begin to fail. But he couldn't control that, and we have made him bring in the sedimentation rain cargo shipping containers. I'm not sure the proper
frack
term.
Frack
tank. Thank you. Yes. That's certainly an option here. We have a bit of room as compared to the intersection on Charles and Haverhill. So if that's the route that if that's the route we need to go, then that's certainly what we'll do. And groundwater is obviously something that we'll probably be working against.
Yeah. And just so that I understand the plan, the pressure, so I assume this pump station, the sewer, the wastewater coming in here is pressurized, right? So, but the wastewater line is underneath the bottom of stream.
Correct.
Do I have that right?
It all comes in via gravity to the wet well or to the new wet well.
Oh, okay. Got it.
And then, it is pressurized on the way out.
So it flows by gravity.
Yes. Well, I believe so. There could be homes at the further extent that are pumped via to another gravity main that comes in, but all of this, by the time it gets here, it's all gravity fed. There could be a small pump station upstream that I can't think of right now, but this is all gravity fed. The effluent discharge, which unfortunately goes under the brook, would be pressurized.
Right.
And, you know, that's kind of our only option to reconnect. If we wanted to move it, we would have to tear that stuff up. And then there's a CMP culvert, 48-inch CMP. Those don't hold up. So I don't think there's really no other option other than grabbing it as far back from the brook as we can in order to – you don't really want to have too many bends either on your effluent piping. You lose your head loss. So I think they've got a proposed 22 up there. So that's really the closest spot away from the river we can get back on the existing discharge line.
Pretty
yep.
close.
Thank you.
No problem.
All right. Anybody else have questions or comments?
So I have some.
Go ahead, Chuck.
Sure. So, yeah, some of these are just, I'm wondering if you, in reviewing our tree policy, I heard it was unclear, so I just wanted to just verify. Our tree policy asks for at least 2.5-inch caliper trees, and you said that these basswoods are going to be 2-inch. Is what's the reason for the 2-inch caliper?
Maggie, have you talked to the landscape architect?
I do not know why he picked 2 inches. I guess maybe we didn't realize that the requirement was a minimum of 2.5. So we can make a change and make the go with the larger diameter.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm sure that's not a problem.
I was wondering if you could show me is there a screen that shows the existing pavement and then the 450 plus or minus feet that are being removed from that impervious surface?
I think one of the slides
is it that one?
Yeah.
That one.
So if you look at that slide and if you see the gray area, so the gray area is kind of like a complete rectangle. So the area that's now green, that's the reduction.
All right, so this is staying and you're removing this area here. Do I have that right?
That's part of it, yeah. So you have to flip back to the one of the beginning slides that shows the entire, there, see? That's the existing parking lot in gray.
So if you're looking at where that station is, the pavement used to go past that and above that, it would no longer be doing. Yeah, that area up there is getting removed, and anything.
So this is underground. This all is underground, and it looks like you're taking all this pavement in here away.
Yep, that's correct. The whole thing is underground. The only thing above ground is the generator, and it's surrounded by crushed stone, so the water would run off there and infiltrate. And we're also going to be adding a curb to that line you're looking at there. And that'll come out to a catch basin now, rather than going directly to the brook as it does now.
And on this line here that I'm going back and forth on, it's exactly where the old pavement is because of the, can't get any closer than the existing, in a redevelopment, you can't get any closer to the riverfront than the existing impervious surface. So this is exactly where the old pavement line is.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're not going any closer.
Okay. Yeah. I was hoping for a reduction.
I believe we might be going further, but certainly not closer. Sorry.
Yeah, I was hoping for a reduction on this side, but I've been out there, and actually this parking lot, how it exists now, actually helps out with people visiting here if they choose to park there or not. So it's not the worst thing.
There is a certain amount of clearance that those large back trucks, they do need a certain amount of room in order to get two trucks in there backed up to the station to bail it out or work on it too. But I believe we cheated the impervious back as much as we could.
So you did this, no disturb. Okay, you did that. And then the only other questions I have is you mentioned stockpile area, and is that on the plan? Is that at least located further away from this pump station?
Yeah, that's probably not on the plan, given that that's a bit of means and methods. And truth be told, I do think the soil sampling we did indicates that it all has to come out. So I don't believe there'd be much material there. And given the playground right behind us and the wetlands and riverfront to the right, if there was a stockpile, it would probably be on the edge of Pine Ridge Road. And I've asked Maggie to include that erosion controls be placed around any stockpile if if they are on site. But I don't believe that, I think it's going to be offloaded and brought in and put down as quickly as they could. But go ahead.
You've mentioned means and methods before, and I'm trying to understand that term, and I think what it means to me is somehow the contractor is responsible for devising his own system for doing a certain thing, but the Conservation Commission would, you know, prefer that, like a stockpile area, something that we usually condition where these are located further away. How could we meet and figure out, like, to have something on the plan showing an area, hey, pick anywhere in this area, but it has to be in this area or something like that? I don't know if
you
talk through that.
Maggie, do you know where the 25 falls on this? I mean, we could certainly say it's got to be outside the 25 and no closer than the existing station or the proposed station. I'm all for limiting where he can put it. That makes total sense to me. I just can't tell him if we can circle an area and say you have to be within this target zone, or we could say you can't be within here. That seems reasonable to me.
So is this no closer than the existing station would be this edge of pavement right in here, where I'm going back and forth on? So it would be to the left of that cursor?
Yes, yeah, we could say, yeah, that's where the generator will end up going. But
we're talking about stockpiling, not, I mean, if you're digging and you're working, that's fine. But if they found out that the soil could be maintained on site, where's it going? Where's that stockpile area? If it could be on that side of the pump station, and the pump station parking in the paved area, that would be great.
Yeah, I think just knowing how he's going to have to dig the old one out and put the new one in, he's going to want to clear that area on the parking lot so he can work in there. And we could write it that it needs to be to the, I guess, west of the existing station. If you want to include that in your conditions, I'm all for that. Or we could put it on the plans if you prefer. Knowing how deep this station is going to be and how large of an excavation, he doesn't have enough area to keep all the soil there anyway, but we can certainly point him in the direction of where you'd like him to go.
Sure.
Yeah, I think what I'd like to see, what I'd like to see is, you know, essentially as a condition that it's, you know, the soil will be direct loaded. If a stockpile is necessary, it will be located further than the existing pump station from the stream. I think if we've got that as a condition, it would be good. You know, if we put these order of conditions together, doesn't mean everybody always reads it. So I think it'd be good if you could include that somewhere on your drawings, just so that usually hits the contractor in the face of like, yeah, this is part of the work. This is
the west of the existing pump station.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
That way we that we know it's not getting closer.
And this is something, is why we review the orders of conditions through the commission. Someone else could remember that, and I may write it down, but it can get corrected. I had one more question. So there's going to be a lot of work close. Seems like there's going to be a lot of work close to the river, and there's been some work there already. What erosion control, or what type of erosion control are you speccing in this document? Is it just, well, I'll let you speak.
I'll let Maggie take the first crack at that, but I can follow up if we need to.
Well, we were just, going to spec the compost logs, but we certainly could add a sediment fence, you know, so it would be, you know, a stronger defense, so to speak, along the top of the stream, of the retaining wall for the stream.
Between that pipe that is getting connected into the existing main, there doesn't seem to be a lot of room You know, I was just wondering if you proposed some sort of, you know, blanket or something to trap anything that goes over the edge of the bank. But I mean, I'm not a favor of, in favor of mulch socks or those. I think just silt fence and maybe a construction fence to highlight it would be, you know, a good idea. Mulch sock may work elsewhere on the site. But yeah, I'd like to hear what other commissioners think.
Yeah,
this is Chuck. Nika, Chuck.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I agree Chuck. I agree with you, Chuck. It's quite a drop. There's quite a big drop from the top of that channel wall. Yeah, from the top to the bottom. You know, so it's also a safety issue. You know, thinking about it, hopefully they're going to be excavating a fairly narrow area to get down to this pipe. But yeah, excavating in that area, dewatering in that area, and seeing how that affects the stream and this and that wall. I'm not expecting it's going to damage the wall or cause an issue in the stream. But mistakes happen and difficult pipes are hard to work with. You know, it would be good to have something really that, like Chuck recommended, at the top of that.
Think about, yeah.
With that, so, I mean, silt fence and hay bales, certainly, I don't mind putting that in there instead of the mulch sock. As far as the construction fence, are you thinking like the orange snow fence?
Yeah.
You know, to, okay. Yeah,
a little more height. It doesn't do anything but highlight, you know, the area to the operator. So maybe that'll work, but you know, I'll take any suggestion. I just know that we're really close in this area, and mulch sock, 12-inch mulch sock is, you know, it can't hold up against these machines. So
no,
that was just my one comment, and I'm finished with my comments.
Yeah, I would also, I guess I'll add, I would imagine that he's gonna have a construction, like one of the, you know, portable fences on the concrete footings. This whole site will have to be contained. And there's no way, he's not going to put that fence on the other side of the river. So I would imagine he'd actually, like you're saying, would put, you know, a chain link fence on those concrete footings pretty much right behind or right on top of that concrete head wall so the site is safe. And that
sure.
Could stay up while he's constructing it. So,
was pounded post or something like that, or the cement blocks, and it had the privacy screening, that would provide a little bit of protection also, because the fence is 6 foot high.
Yeah, the only concern I have with the pounded post is there's also a 24-inch drain line. So I've actually talked to the consultant about moving that connection back. If you look on your screen, there's near the bottom of this picture, there's the 48-inch CMP culvert. There's also, for some reason, they ran a 24-inch RCP right down the same line rather than daylighting it into the culvert or the headwall itself. I have no idea. We really just found that when we were excavating the headwall for the first project. So the location of that Y connection has to go back even further, because I've already called out that conflict. So as long as we can get something between the drain and the headwall, we certainly will have to keep the site safe.
I'll tell you, Alex, you know, from my perspective, you know, I think when I first saw these plans, I think I mentioned to Chuck, I saw where that connection was made, and I just, wow, there's a mess of pipes going on there. I couldn't even necessarily pick out which one it was going to. I think the further you were able to move that back, I mean, for you, from a design standpoint, it seems like it makes sense, but the further you're able to move that back is better for getting away from the wall, getting away from the river, leaving some room to get erosion controls in there. So
yeah, that's something that we were talking about last week. So it's tough because even the existing effluent pipe, the records from 1965 are not that good. You know, we've seen that pipe and we have a pretty good idea on it, but between those two pipes, you know, there is going to be some sort of finessing, and it'll always lean further away from the river. I'm not intending on getting any closer, so it might be that the meter vault comes out a little further and then dips around the corner a little softer, but you know, that connection is something we've got to keep safe and keep the head wall up.
Do you need to do any sort of potholing or, you know, geophysical survey to locate that, the line you're connecting to, or you just kind of feel like once you dig out the existing pump station, you'll have a better idea of where that's going?
I got a quick glimpse of it when we had that, the stream bed was dried out and we put that block headwall in. So I'm pretty confident that's the line it takes, and we do have some plans that indicate that location. But once we dig that station out, it'll run in a pretty much straight line once it gets off that parking lot, and then we can get that final location nailed down pretty well.
Okay.
So I do think it'll be cheap. Oh.
Go ahead, Andrew. Anika, you can finish.
No, I was just going to add, I do think it'll be cheated back towards the parking lot. At least, you know, a couple more feet, because that's a 2-foot drain pipe. So that's going to take up a bit of space.
Okay. Thanks. I just have one more question. That is, thinking ahead to all this being done perfectly, what are the plantings going to look like on the areas where pavement used to be? And structure used to be.
So the pavement will be reinforced turf. Maggie, I don't know if you had a detail for that, or you could speak further on how that'll look. The privacy screen for the residents in the area will be very well landscaped with some arborvitaes and some other low lines. There's really no. The existing area where the force main is sort of just a grass lawn. I'd anticipate that going back. But if the commission wanted some sort of plantings near the headwall or near the brook, that's certainly something we could discuss. But it is sort of a well-used walking path, it seems. And whenever I'm out there, you know, doing sites, it does seem like people do traverse in that area quite a bit. The plantings from the last job came in really well along the bank, but I'm open to discussions on that. But the station itself will be pretty mundane, other than the privacy fence and that area to make that look better.
Okay, is the reinforced turf synthetic?
No, I believe it's like a concrete stamp that has holes for grass to go through, so it's sort of like a paving. It's sort of like a paved armor stone that the grass you can drive on. That's, you know, 50-50 impervious, I guess is the way I
okay.
understood it. Maggie, are you feel the same way about that?
I'm not seeing Maggie on here.
Yes, yeah. Yes, that's my understanding.
Oh.
Too. I'm sorry, I was on mute.
Oh. Okay.
I don't have any other questions.
Any other? Go ahead, Carl.
Just on the additional planting, we just from a couple minutes ago at the head wall. If I'm just want to clarify, the head wall is sort of closest to the existing asphalt, and the guardrail is above it, right? And the trailhead is sort of 30 or 40 feet up the road, right? Meaning would planting be in the way of the trail, or did I misread that?
No, not particularly. The trail really doesn't start till you enter the parking lot, and then you sort of head north towards the baseball field there. There was some talk about getting it to loop around the park a bit. The issue with planting there is that you do have that 24-inch drain pipe.
Yeah.
So, you know, anything, and that's not very deep. It's maybe 3 feet deep or so. So you're really not going to get anything too well established in that area other than some wildflowers or you know, whatever you can get down. But it's really a small area between the parking lot and the head wall and the stream there.
Okay.
So the extent of the plantings is the three large pine trees come out and three new basswood go in. And we can increase that diameter. They probably just weren't aware that it was 2.5 inches on that.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. It looks like we have a question from the public. I'm going to unmute Ms. Safina. If you could just announce your name and your address, and you can ask your question.
Sure. Thank you. Can you hear me, Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
Okay. Yes. Nick Safina, 221 South Street. I just have a couple of comments or questions. Those trees that are coming out, they provide some significant shade to the playground immediately north. You just required a 6-inch tree on a residential property. I don't understand why we wouldn't require something larger here as a replacement. 2.5-inch tree is going to take forever to get up to the level. These are providing shade for that playground.
Yeah, so the way our policy is set, so I think what you're referring to on one of the previous projects, what qualifies under our commission, where we start paying attention, is when a 6-inch tree is being removed. And so it's not that a 6-inch caliper needs to go back. We set a minimum caliper for what can be considered that replacement. But to your point, that's, you know, these trees, I mean, we can see from this picture here, you know, I think you can see the edge of the playground there, the fencing. Right now, these trees are providing a decent amount of shade to the full park area.
Yeah, so I think you should make consideration for that. The second part, which I think is more important, is you're placing a diesel generator within 30 feet of that playground. So I'm wondering what the exercise is going to be for that generator. Are they going to be running that for X number of minutes every week or month? Also,
I'd probably feel more confident. I do know that they do have to be turned on in order to be maintained properly. It is an emergency generator, so it would not be turned on unless we had a large power failure. But they do need to be exercised. The rate at which they do need to be exercised, I don't know offhand. It might be once a week. It could be once a month. And we could work out the time on that, and I could give you a better answer on that. I'm sorry, I don't have that information.
Okay, well, I mean, that's something that really needs to be looked at. I thought National Grid ran a gas line down here recently. They certainly ran it down South Street, you know, the portion of South Street, the main. So there might be natural gas down here as well, if that's any better.
The noise wouldn't. Go ahead, Maggie.
Yeah, I believe it is. It's a natural gas backup generator, and also I'd like to speak to the. We did look into try to save the three pine trees, but there's just no way that we can, because we have to remove the existing station. So yeah, there's no, unfortunately, no way of saving those three trees.
Okay. The last comment I had was that your enclosure around the generator, I think it shows a gate, but I'm not sure that you put the gate up on the Charles Street one for access, right? I think it's left open.
It's up. I think I drove by that. I'm checking to see if it's on Google Maps right now, but
no, it's not.
Yeah, it hasn't been updated. It's certainly up there. I drive by it pretty often. It's a very well sturdy built fence, and it the area on here will end up looking a lot better even visually than it did before. Actually, if you go to Google Maps, you if you're on you can't really see it much, but if you cursor back up Haverhill Street, they do have an image of the fence, but we can supply a picture, but it is in our rendering. If Chuck, you want to move to the end of it, the area right now is pretty. That parking lot's in pretty rough shape. So other than you know, the large trees being gone, the site will look quite a bit more neat, in my opinion.
It's fine the way it is right now. It's kind of quiet. It won't have the noise of a generator running, you know, once a month. Anyways, those are my comments. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I'm just going to follow up on that question. Do we have, I know that there's three of these basswoods going in, but do we have a planting list for what I'm seeing next to the fence? Looks like.
Yes.
That's okay.
There's a key in the right corner. Let me get to the.
There's a planting schedule on the sheet
L2, I think.
I just wanted to make sure of that.
L2, yep.
Yeah.
That's the sheet.
Yeah, there's, you know, some natives and things. I mean, it looks like a typical planting, but it's a nice list.
Okay.
Now, just to follow up with that, so the pines that are coming down, the new ones, the new trees that are going up, are those located closer to the playground area? Because it looks like it's outside of the turf zone, right?
Yeah, it'll be more or less in the same spot. There's not a lot of room between those pines and the playground now, maybe 10, 15 feet. So you're pretty much, it's pretty much going in the same spot.
A little bit closer to the playground, actually, but not by slightly closer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now the thought is the basswood going to grow as tall as the pines? Is it a full size 30 plus foot tree?
Yeah. Plus? Yeah.
Okay.
Much larger than a white pine.
Yeah, as you said, they can get 40 feet, 50 feet tall.
Sure.
To the question earlier about the size, in my speaking with our tree warden, bigger necessarily isn't better, given that, and Carl, so you seem like the tree guy on the commission, but those larger trees would take so much water to get established that they may not hold. But if the commission feels that a larger tree is better, then we'll add it to the plans.
It's just that it's part of our policy and everyone else in town has to do it.
I think, sorry, John.
No, I meant that.
You mean a 6-inch caliper tree or something of a mature, the 2.5-inch caliper is what we are, our policy, which is, you yep. seem to, which you'll oblige. And then the comment from the public was if it was a much larger tree installed with a canopy for shade, that I you know, that would be a tough replacement, I think. But, you know, 2.5 or 3-inch caliper could be, you know, would work. But.
So there's no, I mean, that comment by the tree warden was more or less between the 2-inch and the 2.5-inch probably is
No, I was not related to this project, just mentioning, you know, putting in a 8-inch caliper tree may not work out as well as you intended. That was sort of my...
Yeah, eight inches not, yeah, we all... So the original tree policy was developed with Bob Keaton, and he made the recommendations.
For that 2.5, yeah.
Yeah, 2.5 or 3, and then the cost for what they, you know, for the public, for what it costs for each one of those to go in. So, all right.
All right. Do I hear any other comments? Are there any other items? I'm not hearing any. So, I mean, I think there's a couple things here, Alex, but I mean, you know, from my perspective, you know, I don't see any big items. What I heard were just some confirmation on the generator and what that is. The revisions to the tree caliper, just making sure there's either a stockpile area on the plan or some sort of note or comment to make sure that it's located further away from the stream than the pump station. Did I miss anything?
A depth of the force main, and I'm not sure this is within our purview. It may be, but how often is the generator run to for maintenance?
And I think, Chuck, we were just gonna maybe triple check if what the main source, power source is, if it's generator or
diesel.
Yeah. But.
So how would you guys typically ask for a response, in writing, or do we need to continue this for our next meeting, or are these kind of?
So the Public Services Department came out with a policy during CV19, and we are not supposed to close any meeting on the first night that it's heard. So you're automatically going to the second meeting, and your response would be great and written down, so I could send it out to the commission.
Okay.
Provide,
Chuck, do you think I would just propose, I mean, just understanding what's left, is this one of those situations where we leave the meeting open, but we prepare the order for the next meeting with the assumption that we get these responses?
What
responses at this point are not clear?
So we just went through those, Dave, but I'll read them again. So it's
I don't think that whether it's a gas or diesel generator is in our purview. That's not in the size of the tree is according to our tree policy. So what else is there that's open?
The depth of the force main. There was a question about whether it's gas or diesel. Where the stockpile area is located.
Gas is not within our purview.
Well, the question stemmed from, my question was the utility. If they're trenching an 18-inch deep trench from 300 yards away, where's the power coming from? I just didn't know if there was anything to do with that. That was my only question. That was just my only question or concern.
Dave, what are you getting at, I guess, is the question.
Yeah.
What are the questions that remain open?
I think we've gone over them. I think I've heard them like a couple times. You know, we've got multiple questions that we've asked for revisions to.
What is in our purview? That's my question. Whether it's a gas or diesel generator is not in our purview.
I think what we just heard from Carl, right, is that if there's – go ahead.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman, how is a diesel tank within 200 feet of the riverbank not in your purview?
Dave?
There would be no on, I'm very confident there's no on-site storage of diesel. which is why
it would be a belly tank. If you had a diesel generator, it would be a belly tank.
Yeah, that's not on the plans. So I don't believe that it's diesel. I may have misspoke earlier. I was not aware of the power source.
I heard Maggie say gas.
It is a natural gas. That's what we had in notice of intent.
Yeah, unfortunately, like I said earlier, I don't have my plans in front of me on the computer, but if Maggie has the plans, it would be called out. So
yeah, it's a natural gas generator. There's no diesel.
And that's what I heard her say, that she said it was a natural gas.
That was included in the notice of intent as well, that information that it's going to be a natural gas backup generator. So I apologize for that confusion.
Okay.
But I mean, we can certainly add any, we will, when we update the plans per your revisions here, we can show any trenching that would be required for any connection to the generator there.
Unless that's not how the commission feels, I don't want to add work to the list. I don't know.
No, I think we just talked about it a bunch. I think it's worth making sure that's clear.
Yeah.
We'll provide a written response and update the plans for your, concerns, your comments. It's not a problem.
Alex, I have a question. On the depth of the force main question that's out there, would the depth of the existing station be sufficient? Because our plans from 1965 don't have a profile. And the force main, it may leave the station at 15 feet. It could be anywhere from 5 to 15 in that area. We're really not going to know until we get out there. And knowing that we won't be taking down the head wall either way, I'm not sure how relevant that really is.
Well, just depth of excavation.
Yeah. Okay.
How much stockpiling. That's
fine.
It's all about piecing it together and making sure that there's no alteration in the resource area. So, like I said, we are, the protocol is that we cannot close. We have to listen or have this open for two hearings. And then the chair just said, well, is there an issue with starting to write the permit or having that written during these two? And I think that's fine. I think that works. And that fits into the policy.
Great. Yeah, I mean, I think that there's not a lot left here. I think we're pretty close. I think you've kind of answered where our questions were. I think if we can get some written responses and an update, I think we should be in good shape. So I don't see a reason why this isn't something that is settled at the next meeting. So.
All right, great.
All right. Do I hear a motion?
I make a motion to continue the, is it a notice of intent? It must be. Notice of intent for 0 South Street.
Second.
Chuck, do we have a file number for this? Sorry to.
Oh yeah, hold on a second. I know it came in.
Okay, it wasn't on the agenda.
It got cut off on the agenda, it looks like.
There is a file number for this. If it's not on the agenda, I shouldn't bother looking. Okay, so I did check tonight.
Okay.
And everything has a file number.
Okay. So sorry, Nico. I figured it would be worth getting it in there if we had it, but you can just say 0.
No, I have it now. I have it now. It's 270-0735.
So I make a motion to continue the notice of intent 270-0735 0 South Street to the next meeting.
Second.
Michael Flynn in favor.
Anika Scanlon in favor.
next?
Was it Bob
Dave.
Or Dave? Or Carl Ciccone in favor?
Yep. John Sullivan in favor?
Martha Moore in favor?
Scott Keith in favor?
Come on, Dave's here.
Yeah,
I lost
power with the computer. I had to go over to the phone.
No worries. So I'll give you the quick quote because we just voted. But so we've made a motion to continue.
I'm in favor.
All right. Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Maggie.
All right. Thank you all for your time. Yeah. Have a good night.
That's great. That's good. Thank you, Maggie.
All right. Next item on the agenda, 23 Temple Road. This is opening a new hearing for notice of intent filed by Daniel and Michelle Grappi under the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, and the Wetland Protection Bylaw, Section 7.1. The project includes constructing an 18-by-20-foot two-story addition with a full basement within the 100-foot buffer zone to the bordering vegetated wetland. Map number 16, lot 340. Chuck, do we have a DEP file number for this one? Yes. Probably just one plus whatever you just told me.
It was Temple Street, right? So it's 270-0734.
270-0734. Now turn it over to the applicant. Jack, are you presenting?
Yep. For the record, my name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. I just wanted to give the commission some background on this. The applicant did appear before the Zoning Board of Appeals on August 5th, and they received approval for a special permit for this addition. So now we're following up with you since all this work falls within the 100-foot buffer zone. Norse Environmental flagged the wetlands. The proposed two-story addition is 75 feet from the bordering vegetated wetlands, and our limit of work line is 58 feet from the wetland line. We are removing one 26-inch hardwood tree, which...
Not that one. One second.
I'll let Chuck pull that up. Yep. So right to the rear of the proposed addition, there's a 26-inch hardwood tree that we're going to be removing in a long... Along the right side, where there's an existing 6-foot high stockade fence, we're proposing to plant 3 arborvitaes. The owner may look to plant some additional native plantings in the rear yard as well, but we at least wanted to satisfy your tree policy with these plantings. To provide some mitigation, I know the commission in the past has looked for drainage mitigation for roof runoff. I am showing a 500-gallon dry well to be put in. But in talking with the owner and thinking more about this, we probably have a high groundwater table on this site. So we would like to do like a crushed stone drip trench along the drip line to the addition instead of the 500-gallon dry well. We are showing a 12-inch diameter stake mulch sock to be placed at the limit of work line. The proposed site grading is matching the existing site grades within about 6 inches. And there'll be no soil stockpiling with this project. You can see the existing house and the proposed addition is very close to Temple Street. So when they excavate out for the full basement material, any excess material loaded right out on truck and removed from the site. I think that about completes my presentation. I just so the commission knows, proof of certified mailings were sent to Chuck showing that all abutters were notified as part of this public hearing. And I'll turn it over to the commission to see if they have any questions.
Okay, I'll open it up to the group. But you know, overall, what I see is you got work that's occurring 75 feet away from the wetland. The limit of work is 58 feet away, so it seems relatively straightforward. But I'll open it up to the group if there's somebody that has questions or comments. None from the group? Mike? Yeah, go ahead.
So you said that there was going to be a drip trench. Where can you sort of describe where the perimeter of that will be?
So it would have to go along the side of the addition. I'd have to check with the architect to see how the roof is going to drain. But it would basically be a 2 foot wide by 2 foot deep drip trench, right? However the roof line drains, we'd have to place it in that location. When you look at the rear of the lot, the wetland line is probably around elevation 91. And where I was proposing the dry well is around elevation 94. And the dry precast dry well is about 3 feet deep. So that might even be into the water table. So I think the drip trench would work better for this site. But I'd have to get some clarification on how the roof is pitched and how it would be collected.
So because of that, you bring up an interesting point. You say that this proposed addition is also going to have a finished basement.
Correct.
What about the water table there?
It's above the water table. The finished floor, if the finished first floor is at elevation 100, and there'll be about 9 feet to the basement floor. So it'll be slightly above the water table.
Okay,
it's got, so we'll be okay with that.
I don't have any other questions.
I could fill in this spot. So Jack, could we get, just because we're usually doing 500 gallon dry wells, could you give us a detail on the drip trench and probably filter fabric and size stone and all that?
Yep.
Those three trees that you're replacing, you're removing one tree. What kind of tree is that? And then you're replacing it with, you said it, but I just missed what you said.
Yeah, there'll be 3 5-foot high arborvitaes planted. It's a hardwood tree. I'm not sure if it's a maple or an elm or what it is, but it's definitely a hardwood tree that's being removed.
Okay. And it's a full down foundation. Are you expecting to do I don't know what they're called other than to say a French drain, perimeter drain, something like that?
Yes. I think it's required by building code. So I think we'll have to.
Where's the discharge point?
I didn't show that. It would have to be within our limit of work. I don't know if it won't outlet to like a gravity discharge. It would have to go into some crushed stone area. So I should probably show that on the plan.
Sure. Well, if it's in the limit of work, that would be great.
Yeah, I can do that.
Jack, I have a quick question. At the existing back sort of right corner of the house, if you're facing the house, there's the tree to be removed, and then there's sort of like a evergreen shrub right there. So the grade kind of slopes immediately down there. So if we have a foundation and the addition and the tree is removed, is there anything proposed or what will happen sort of in that corner of the house? Just sort of graded back to existing, you know, or...
Right. So now next to that 26 inch tree, you'll see there's an existing stone retaining wall.
Yeah.
The back of the addition, I show a proposed grade of 95. And just beyond that little retaining wall, we're at 93.8. So there's about a 1.2 foot grade change there. So they may have to keep that section of wall there to add the grade break. That's why I showed it. But it may be something when they're in the field, they can say, we don't need this, and they can grade it out because, you know, over that distance, they may be able to slope, you know, at less than three
yeah, to three, one. Three, 3-1. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Any other questions from the commission? I'm looking to see if Mike is.
Sorry, I was on mute. Any other questions? All right, I'm not hearing any. Any questions from the public? I'm not hearing any as well. All right. I mean, we just went through this on the last one, but I think this is a similar situation. I think these items seem relatively straightforward. I would like to see, I mean, a revised plan, Jack, just identifying where the drip trench is.
Yep.
So that we can make sure that we're getting what we need. And I think Chuck had a great question and great point associated with, you know, the discharge of those the laterals, the
the foundation drain.
Exterior drains. Yep. Yeah, thank you.
Yep. I have no problem. I have no problem with that. And because we're in the appeal period with the zoning board now, so if you meet in 2 weeks, I have no problem seeking to continue at get you the information on those two items and come back before you in 2 weeks.
Great. Get a motion.
I move we continue the hearing for 270-0734 23 Temple Road.
Second.
The next meeting.
Second.
Michael Flynn in favor.
Nika Scanlon in favor.
David Tennant in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha is muted. Go ahead, Martha.
There we go. Martha Moore in favor.
Scott Keith in favor.
All right. Thank you.
All right, Jack. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, guys.
Oh, we have someone clapping.
What's that?
I'm just saying that someone's clapping. I thought it was raising their hand, but my mistake.
Okay. Moving on to the next item on the agenda. This is 11 Plymouth Road. This is an RDA. Filed by Lindsay Dement. Applicant proposes to remove the front portion of the existing roof and rebuild it at a higher elevation to create more living space on the second floor, the exterior wall, to align the existing street facing on the facing wall on the first floor. This addition is a vertical extension only and will not extend beyond the existing established building footprint. There are no site modifications or tree removal impervious. The application and plans can be viewed on the conservation page. This is map 26, lot 110, file number RDA 2020-7. I'll turn it over to the applicant and they can explain the project.
Yeah, good evening. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
This is Michael Seacamp Environmental Consulting. Okay, I can see myself there now. Hey. The project has gone back and forth. Originally, they were going to do a little bit more aggressive on the outside, but basically the only work on the outside of the house is the front wall that is up toward Plymouth Road. And yeah, there's the it's basically the existing conditions. And you can see my wetland line. I delineated the wetlands probably back in, I think it was in March. Bordering vegetated wetlands, A1 through A13. It gets runoff from Route 129. And but the project basically, as I said, is that is the front wall is going to be raised about 3 feet. And the roof line will be shaped differently, but the overhang will be the same as it is now. So there's actually no increase in impervious surface with this project. We do have a plan also that shows the laydown of materials, which will be on the street side of the house. We also show the location of the porta potty. And in addition to the front wall of the building being raised, there'll be some work on the inside. Yeah, there's the architect's plan there. And that also shows the wetland lines. The existing house is, part of it is within 25 feet of the wetland. Obviously 35 feet. The 100-foot buffer zone goes all the way out, even across the street in some areas. So. We do show erosion control on this plan. However, there's really not much likelihood that there'll be anything to erode, but it will also act as a limit of work and keep people away from the wetland area. So that'll go in there. That's that jagged line there on the rear of the house. So I'll be happy to answer any questions.
So I guess I'll open it up to the commission first. I've got a couple questions, but if anybody was able to do a site visit and has any questions, I'll open it up to you guys first. Carl, I know you were talking about potentially getting out there. I don't know if you had a chance to.
I did a drive-by, and then I've just been sort of, I didn't, again, as I was kind of reading the, it seems, I don't know, pretty straightforward, I think.
Go ahead, Anika.
Thanks, Mike. So on the plan I see that was emailed to me, it looks like there's also going to be sort of like a roof covering over the front walk entrance. Is that, did you describe that? Is that still happening?
No. No, just what you see there is what's existing, and there will not be any change from the plan view that you see. The only change is a vertical wall in the on the street side of the house.
Okay, and Nikki, I think I saw the same thing you were looking at. Chuck, go back to the proposed plan.
Right.
I think where my
that's what I'm talking about is the proposed plan.
This is where my question was as well. Chuck, do you see the proposed 527-20? Yeah, this.
Yeah, that's not the proposed plan at this point.
Okay.
The only at one point we were going to be filing a notice of intent which would have increased some impervious. But this is a plan that was prepared by the surveyor. So it shows the existing conditions, but that addition that's not part of the plan. The previous plan that you showed from the architect is what it will look like, and there'll be no change in the plan view from the sky. The only change will be vertical.
Okay. So
okay.
728 should be what we're relying on. Not this other piece that was included. Okay.
Okay, I guess I just have a small follow-up question. Bear with me, I'm not a builder. The the demolition part of this, is there going to be some sort of scaffolding, or like how's that going to take place? How is the removal of the roof and the raising of it by 3 feet going to kind of like, what is that going to look like from the outside?
It'll be visible from the street, and there'll be scaffolding, I presume, on the street side of the house, and then they'll be framing it and putting the raised roof on it. It'll be a different angle on the roof then.
So where's the storage dumpster going to go for that activity?
I beg your pardon?
Storage dumpster for the debris. Is that going to be on the driveway?
That's actually shown on the plan, right below that where it says 26.8 feet. You see the 16 by 5 dumpster? Yeah, the dumpster's there, and the staging area is to the left.
Staging area dumpster.
Yeah, that'll be the materials that will be used for construction.
Okay, do you expect any sort of like flyaway material to be generated during this, or no?
No, no, I don't expect it. I would be upset if it happened, I can tell you that. You know, you could make the condition that any debris that fell off would be collected and put in the dumpster. But that's pretty standard practice with most contractors.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. And I think mine was very in line with yours, Anika. I mean, it is so the erosion controls, and I think I was primarily looking at that May 27th plan, but so I'm glad you extended it all the way to the driveway. Is there any need to, you know, is that enough space to be a limit of work area? Do you need to get any equipment back there, or are they going to be picking stuff up from, like, enough room to pick stuff up back there?
No, there won't be any work outside on the back. It's only on the street side, so that'll work. Where we're showing it will work, and as I said, that'll act at more as a limit of work than erosion control, because we don't expect there'll be any erosion since there's no disturbance to the ground.
No, agreed. I think it's a great great delineator of keeping people inside that area and not letting have more space.
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree.
Those were my questions, Anika. Did you have any more?
No. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Chuck?
I was wondering, just to ask, and I think that the answer is no, but there's no trees coming down with this project.
Correct. No trees.
Are you going to propose a foundation drain?
I'm sorry?
A foundation drain, is that part of this project?
No. No.
And then my last question would be, we typically ask for infiltration of the roof runoff. Don't see that.
Well, there's no change to the to impervious on the site.
So how is the roof runoff handled with this new structure? Is it just splash pads on the ground?
Yes. Yeah.
Do you think there's a possibility to divert that into a rain garden or drip trench, something like that? It's pretty close. I'm sure you don't have the elevation out there, but something.
We probably could do that. Yeah, I would think that a infiltration trench would work. We could do that in the front of the house where there's going to be work. I'd be resistant to do digging in the rear just because we're not going to be disturbing anything back there anyway. That would just increase the potential for erosion.
Do you know what roof style this is? Is it just typical
It's going to be, it'll be flatter than it is now.
It's not a shed roof.
Only the front is going to be raised. So, but it'll still be slanted. So you could either have a gutter or you could have a drip edge.
So they're doing like a dormer on the front half of the house, leaving the shingled roof in the back intact.
Yeah, yeah. I guess you could call it a dormer. It'd be like a shed dormer, but it'll go all the way across. And that'll give them more headroom in the upstairs.
And is there there's gutters on the back? Is that correct?
I believe so. Yeah.
I think the only other thing that we ask, and I don't know if anyone did a site visit there, is that these are typical situations where we ask for the yard waste to be picked up. Mike, do you know if there's any yard waste on site here? Since you did the delineation, you might have seen piles of yard waste, but it's typical for the commission to ask for that to be removed during the project.
Yeah, when I was there, there was actually a hockey goal, because apparently it freezes back there, and the boys are able to play hockey on the ice, but that typically gets removed in the spring.
Okay, no, I'm talking about like a brush pile or yard, clippings from grass.
I didn't notice any. When you get over toward Route 129, you get stuff where people throw it out of their cars. That plan there shows it where the head wall is. So you get a little bit of, street trash down that end.
Mm-hmm. Chuck, for what it's worth, I went by. I didn't do a detailed look in the back there for yard waste, but I mean this is on the backside of what is currently going in of
364 Wall Street.
Yes. Yeah. And so two or three years ago, I think we'd seen a lot of trash there, but I think as part of that project, a lot of the stuff off this property has been cleaned up. I think in general, what I felt like is everything just kind of looked a lot better than what I remember it from 2 years ago. There wasn't something that stood out to me.
Are you talking about the project across the wetland?
It's a pretty
significant project going on over there. I'm not familiar with it, but it's ongoing.
And there was some work associated within the wetlands that they were doing out there. So on their property, obviously. But so I think as part of that, they did some pretty decent cleaning of that area.
Okay. Everyone in the audience, yeah?
Do we have any comments from the public? Not hearing any. All right. I mean, I think Mike, I think you're right. My perspective, I think this is a relatively straightforward project. It is very close to the wetlands. So yeah. Obviously I think there's concerns there, but ultimately I think the erosion controls, the way you've shown them here, kind of help set up and where the staging and the dumpster will be, help set up that you guys are taking the right approach here. With that, I'll open it up to the commission. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion to issue a negative determination with conditions as presented today.
Second. Mike Flynn in favor.
Anika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
Scott Keith in favor.
Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good presentation, Mike. All right. Moving on to old new business. Chuck, we've got a decent amount of people in the meeting still. Is there a certain item in the old new business that we want to hit first? Do you know?
Just our fans.
Nah, fan club it is. Okay.
I'm not aware. I see Will's iPad, but I'm not. I mean, you can unmute them and ask each one of them if there's something, and then you can change the agenda at this point.
Yeah, I mean, in the interest of time, if there's an aspect that they're here for, to just figure to move it up. Looks like Will just left.
Yeah, it seemed like they might have been here for Plymouth.
Yep. Okay.
All right,
so we'll 53 Arcadia. Sounds like we already hit on that. We're not doing anything for this one at this point, right?
That's right. They're going to come back to us when that RDA is complete. And then 18 and 22 Small Lane. Martha and I went out for a site visit, and we talked to the homeowner. And if you want to, Martha, you can chime in. I'm gonna pull up the plan because I think it'll be easier to tell the commission what we found. I'll just do that, and then start speaking again. Here we go. So me and Martha went out there. I think we came out the day after the last meeting, which was July 22nd. And we saw, let me get this highlighting tool. So first off, this area here, as Dave Panette said, is quite messy. It's a lot of overgrown area, but it's really overgrown almost exactly where the disturbed area is. Just beyond it looked like a typical forest, and there was less herbaceous material on the ground, less growth, and you could walk through it. But between this side here, and I believe this is 18 over here, and right about here, and then somewhat back in this area, it was buckthorn, multifloral rose, and bittersweet. And for some big trees that were there, and those aren't being proposed to take down, there was swamp oak, red maple, and white pine. We couldn't tell if any of these plants looked like they were planted originally from the restoration plan. They did look very much like volunteer growth, and the multiflora rose is quite thick in some areas. So after discussing this with the homeowner, who's going to work on this property also, we thought that we would break up the work into two sections. And it seemed that if the invasive species were pulled out, and the commission had a chance to look at it at that point in this area, in this lot A area, we could make suggestions or look to see if some native volunteer growth would move in. Homeowner thought that was a good idea, and he may be doing the work himself or hiring someone to do that. And then once he's done, he'll contact us and then proceed of compliance. Over here on this other lot was quite a different situation. There was only two or three areas that were small that needed to be looked at. There's a pool in the back, and it's a very highly maintained landscaped area inside the fence, and outside the fence had the look of just a normal New England forest. And I don't know if he planted that, but what had happened over here on lot A somehow didn't happen on lot B. And so there's less to do there. So that may already been completed. I haven't got an update, but it seems like lot A's most of the problem. So after the work is finished, he's going to call myself or the commission and to go out there and talk about next steps. That's what I know about the situation. It seemed like he agreed with what me and Martha had asked him to do, and he was willing to do that, and he thought it was a good solution. I don't know if you have anything to add, Martha.
I just wanted to mention the brush pile you found, or the leaf pile you found when you went through the gate in the back, and he's going to clear that leaf pile out, I think, as well.
It's the typical brush pile. There's a gate in the back. The pool and patio area, you know, is, like I said, highly maintained, and there's just a gate, and then just beyond it, there's that brush pile. Thank you, Martha.
And I think he was glad to hear that he had permission to keep the tree branches from growing over the fence. I think that was sort of the issue around the fence, was it was all the plants growing up, and he didn't think he really could maintain those based on the previous conversation. Is that right?
That's right. So he had really left those alone, and there was a lot of limbs just stretching over the fence, kind of reaching into the deck area, and he'll be trimming those back. But again, that property is in much different shape. I think if that was the only property that we were looking at, probably would have approved the certificate of compliance after the brush pile was removed, or promised to remove the brush pile, and maybe just to take out some of the invasives. Really were minimal amounts. There might have been something in this area here, and then something about here that needed to work on. So it was a good site visit. It was a good suggestion. The homeowner's going to take care of that himself and get back to us.
Okay, good. All right, so we'll see what we end up getting.
Thank you both for going out.
Yeah, looks like it was a good review. And I'm glad you're able to coordinate with them.
Yeah.
And keep that moving. All right, order of conditions, 106 Colonial Drive.
Sure, I just need your permission to send that out. You already have the signature signature page from the commission, and the same with 88 Timberneck. Both those could go out.
Did we vote on those last meeting, or were they just closed?
You could just vote to issue the 106 Colonial because it's a notice of intent, and you could just vote to issue. That would be fine. The other one, you don't have to.
I'll make a motion to issue the order of conditions for 106 Colonial Drive, map 40, lot 146, DEP file 270. -0733.
Second.
Mike Flynn in favor.
Anika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
Scott Keith in favor.
Hello, I thought we lost you there, Dave.
I'm doing my phone and it's under charging, so it's got to lay down flat. So that's why you're looking at my ceiling. Lose the power everywhere.
Got it. All right. Sorry. So Chuck, for Tiberneck, that was a determination of applicability. And so we already voted on that. So you're good to send that out.
Yeah, and I've already talked to that homeowner, and I told him after tonight's meeting he could proceed with the work because of the 10-day appeal period.
Okay. All right, 270-0728, this is Zero Haverhill. So, Chuck, you sent us the order of conditions that you had prepared and sent to the applicant. We had received some comments from the applicant. Was that today or late yesterday or whatever, whenever it was?
It was yesterday, and I'll put those up. Okay.
Yep.
And these are the comments. I sent them out to the commission, and I just put down and highlighted in red what my response was. And Bill Crowley, who was Mark Hall's attorney, worked with me through two iterations of this, and they were satisfied at the end, except for they wanted to understand the bond a little bit more. And I don't know if you want to go through this. It's just that what solved one and two is just adding in or conveying the land to the Reading Conservation Commission. So they would just wanted to make sure they actually wanted the conservation restriction out altogether. I was unsure whether the town would accept the gift of that land, the 13 acres. So I wanted to have both options until one happens.
I'll just say for the first item there, because I thought that was an important one. I mean, I think that's in line with what we've discussed. Ultimately, we have the power to issue, to accept something as a conservation restriction, but not necessarily accept the land. I think that's generally done by the select board or town meeting. So I think, you know, we can certainly give our opinion. I think we've talked about this in these meetings that we don't necessarily need it to be a conservation restriction, but I want to leave that open in case for some reason the town manager or the select board has an issue with the two other options that are discussed. Those really aren't our decision to make. So I think we've already indicated in the meetings that not going the restriction route because of timing is makes sense, but we have less control over the stay of those other two items. So as long as it says convey, I think we're covered. So, okay.
Yeah, so, I thought that left our options open. I would prefer to see it be gifted to the town instead of having a restriction, but either way is beneficial.
Right. Sorry, Chuck guy, but I figured that was an important one to just make that clarification.
Sure. Number three talked about the expense of trees. This is something that we're really going to get into once the process has started and the foundation's in and we can see where the framing's going to find out if all the trees need to come down, all 44 of them, or if there's some compromise we can come to. So it was hard to figure out if it met the tree policy or not. So this is my solution, saying that, you know, we actually do a 2.5 caliper tree. That's what we ask for. They understand the shrub part of that. And then there's a one-to-one replacement policy. That seemed to suffice. On number four, it was talking, and Dave Panett brought this up also, there wasn't enough time to build a house and plant, so we extended the monitoring date to 2021, and then we capped the monitoring for 2 years after all the plants are in, so we'll only have 2 years of monitoring to find out if they're safe. And one of the things I just thought of as I was saying that is what survival rate we're going to be looking for at the end of 2 years. So I don't know if anyone wants to let me know, and I'll just write that in also, but that's something that's typically talked about with planting. So 70%, 80%, 90%, 100%, what you're looking for at the end of those 2 years. The first year
what would we be, typically ask for?
I would say 80%, 85%. Is that agreeable?
Yeah, it sounds...
number sounds right. Good to me.
Is that Carl?
Yeah, so if you planted 10 trees, you got to think that 8 are going to make it. It seems fair if someone's paying attention to water. 8.5, sorry. Yes, 8 and a branch will survive.
8 and 2 shrubs.
Right. I mean, I think when you put it in those terms, I think that.
Yeah, it can be 100%. It's up
right.
To.
Yeah.
I guess that's my thought is like, why don't we just ask for 100%? Is that right. There's. But I don't know that
100% survivor rate after 2 years. Okay.
we're gonna be known around the surrounding towns as the enforcers.
So
isn't that what we usually ask for? If a bunch of them have died, we say, well, this one has died. We're looking for a replacement.
It's true. So if you're vegetating a like a detention pond or something like that, it might make more sense to say 85%. But when we're talking about trees and the example Carl just said, 10 and you're gonna lose 2, that doesn't seem like great, like a great
response.
So all right, so the next one, number 6, it just talks about there's not enough room on the site for a 70-foot area. So this actually turned into changing the stockpile area and the tailing basin to 50 feet. And I talked to Maureen, and she thought that was fine. So I wrote on this next one, it's the bond. And I wrote, you know, I understand that on single-family houses, we don't actually, you know, Dave Panett told me, he said on single family houses, we don't usually ask for bonds, but that's not how we apply that, that measure. And we apply it, homeowners are treated differently than contractors. So that's the first piece of information that needs to be known. And then secondly, I wrote up, 44 trees and the cost at with those trees is $13,000. And, you know, that doesn't even include erosion control. These things usually don't happen. I wouldn't mind seeing that lowered a little bit, but I'm not sure $2,500 is going to, you know, in today's day and age, that's not gonna get.
So I would propose 5,000. I was trying to think of the examples before that we've had it, but I feel like that's a number we've used in the past for a project this size.
Lane, it was 5,000.
Strawberry Hill did we do Strawberry Hill too?
Sure.
Yeah.
But
I feel like that's been the number that we've generally had for, you know, a house, something this about this size, this amount of work. I don't expect that 44 trees are actually coming down here, but that's part of that unknown. But so I'd open it up if anybody has some other number that they think, but that seemed like a number we've used in the past. And Chuck, I think you always tend to put this as a high number for us and let us come down when we read the order of conditions, which I think is always better that way than having it be too low and we don't pay attention. Go ahead,
well,
Martha.
I try to base it on something, and they come out high, but I'm not cutting corners, and you guys give you the facts. Yeah.
Aren't they planning to contribute a lot to the tree fund rather than planting all those trees back on the property?
From what I know, all of that is going to be decided later on. So on Randall Road, there was something like 80 trees that this same contractor took down for the three houses. They were able to find most of the spots through their landscaping plan to correct that. So at the end of the day, they might not be contributing anything, but that all comes back to the Conservation Commission when Maureen and I and whoever, whatever, wants to talk to beyond that site visit from the commission.
Okay.
So Martha, just to clarify too, the purpose of this bond is if they start doing work and then abandon the project and disappear from the face of the earth. So there's a cost associated that we try to make sure we recover to make sure we can repair the site, essentially, if there's significant loss. And that's generally what these bonds are for.
Right. So the question is whether $5,000 would be enough money to replant the trees they cut down and bulldozed and then didn't do anything beyond that.
So it also could be, if they planted and then someone didn't take care of them, they died off, and we wanted to have that habitat, we would have that ability to have some contractor go in there and replant what we lost in value.
Do I hear any other numbers? 5,001. All right. Any objections to 5,000?
I don't have any objections to 5.
No.
Okay.
Mike, can you just make sure Anika is unmuted? This seemed like a reasonable change to say that at a point where occupancy is ready, but the exterior landscaping wasn't ready and we weren't ready to issue a certificate of compliance, then I could sign off on the occupancy permit for the building. We've typically done it this way. There was a change when I got here. I think some of these orders of conditions still have some of that old material in there, and it just allowed the Conservation Commission to hold off on occupancy. That's no longer how we do it. So I just wrote in there that if you sign off occupancy after a site visit, and you know, if there's any erosion control issues that need to be taken care of, they're taken care of, then I would sign off and we'd wait for the order of the certificate of compliance for any other repairs. And that was it. That was the entire.
Okay.
Here's the order. that comes up, we have to go back and do this. I got some comments from commissioners also. I incorporated those in there. I apologize for not having track changes on this. I tried several times, but this computer, this laptop that I was given from Reading, you know, doesn't have the full Word complement of software. So track changes aren't in there, but I did add everyone's comments who sent them to me.
Commission is spelled wrong. Don't say I didn't give you edit.
That's funny. Just making a note.
So this 9 and 10 is 9 is the okay.
Yeah, just and then that's just how I handled it. It seems like Bill Crowley let me know that he's had some conversations with the town manager, and they're going to pursue this right away as soon as this order is executed, and at that point I think the transfer of land and ownership would happen, and then Mark Hall would be able to have some serious discussions.
Okay.
And here's the 2.5. They used to say 3-inch caliper, but Jamie's paragraph. All right. So, I mean, essentially what this says is during the transfer, we have to get a piece of paper that says the new owner understands that there's an order of conditions on this property, and we have that paper, and it says, you know, they're not going to be surprised, I guess. And this just says 20% of the bond we can hold. And I thought that was appropriate because 10% didn't seem to be enough. But now that we've reduced it to 5,000, just think about that. So this is when the certificate of compliance is issued. So these, and Dave can probably speak of this better than me. When these are like 4-month projects, maybe 5, and then they're gonna have their order of conditions. We're gonna hold the bond for 2 years. But we're only gonna hold 20%.
So that's basically saving $1,000 in case there needs to be some more trees planted that didn't survive those 2 years.
Right. So if they put 20 trees in, we couldn't do that.
So we should increase that.
But Chuck, if we've got a reporting, you know, they need to report the health, and we're saying they need 100% survivability. Don't we have the right to just go back and issue saying, well.
So you could say that you would, well, you could say that you wouldn't issue the certificate of compliance until the 2-year period is up, and you could get that survivability verified.
Yeah, so the challenge with that is generally if somebody's trying to buy this, they want to have that closed out. Okay.
That's a year and 6 months to wait.
Yeah.
So compliance makes a big deal on a closing or
mortgage.
Paul, the developer, probably end up having to do some special, something special to make sure that they're kept whole. So if the project's done in 5 months and then, maybe by the end of next summer, we issue the certificate of compliance because the grass is completely grown and the trees are planted, and we get that, fall report, there's a whole nother year to wait. So maybe you could say 50% of the bond, and then $20.
Yeah, I think if you put 50, I think that'll cover us for what that is. And that's essentially keeping that same value that was that for, if it's 40%, we're essentially keeping the same value as if it were the 10,000. So
I think that after the first year, they've been, I'd like to see him in the ground for a year. I mean, Carl could probably educate us all on this, but I don't think we should really think that they're going to survive 100% after about 6 months. I mean, it'd have to be at least a year, one winter.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, I'll change that to 50%. And that's it.
All right. Excellent. Do I hear a motion to issue as amended, as we've reviewed?
So moved. Can I do that?
You can.
Second.
All right. Mike Flynn in favor.
Anika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
John Keith in favor.
What?
So the next one is Jane Finnegan. I'm going to just breeze through this. The order of conditions was finished today. That I had put my work together, and it was with our consultant, and she worked long and hard on it all of yesterday, and then finally finished it this morning. But the decision was made that there was not enough time for the commission to review it the day of the meeting and to put enough time into it to make sure that, everything that you remember was talked about during the meeting is in as a condition or mentioned somehow in the order of conditions. So we put that off until our second August meeting, but I am going to send it out to you tomorrow, Friday, so you'll have plenty of time to review it. And I'd like to use track changes again. That seemed to work out fine. So anyone that wants to write in with track changes, I could compile everything with that. So they're just going to wait until our next meeting. Unfortunately, the CPDC has closed with them. Their decision has been written. There's a 20-day appeal period. We have a 10-day appeal period. The difference is 6 days. So by waiting to our next meeting, this is causing the owner a 6-day delay. But it was unavoidable.
Yeah, I mean, this is a big order. We had a third party that prepared this for a reason because it's pretty complex. So I'd like to make sure we have time to review it.
I will mention one thing. The CPDC was wondering, and when we review it, they were wondering who's in charge of maintenance on the boardwalk and path. And I don't remember that coming up in the meetings. So just something to think about. Maybe, and I'm going to ask the Trails Committee if there's any standard maintenance on any of these things in the past. And we do have Maplewood Village, where a boardwalk was supposed to be created. It's very similar to this. It goes right off a project. And was there any maintenance involved? So I'll look into that also.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Chuck.
So you want to get all the rest of these out of the way and then talk about the tree policy?
Yeah.
So it's, I would like you to, I sent out 624 again. I don't know if anyone reviewed it. And then we have 780, but 722 did not get sent out to the commission. I actually just got it days ago.
Yeah, so I saw 624 and 78. I
saw those two as well. I didn't see 724.
I just received that a couple of days ago.
Oh, okay.
I just trying to not pressure the commission too much.
Were there any comments on the minute?
No.
There are none. Can I get a motion?
Can you do separate votes?
Yep.
Make a motion to approve the minutes of 6:24.
A second.
Mike Flynn in favor.
Nika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
Keith in favor.
Make a motion to approve the minutes of 7:08.
I'll second.
Michael Flynn in favor.
Nika Scanlon in favor.
David Pinnett in favor.
Carl Ciccone in favor.
John Sullivan in favor.
Martha Moore in favor.
Doug Keith in favor.
And I have 12 minutes.
I just had one question in old and new business. Have the no dumping signs gone up on Longfellow yet?
They haven't gone up. They're still they're at the shop, I was trying to think of how I would get them out there, but I haven't been in town. I wasn't in town at all this week, so I couldn't pick them up. Any volunteers to pick them up? It's on, it's in Woburn, Michigan Ave. Fast signs, no check required.
How big are they, Chuck?
Oh, like, just, yeah,
like
12
four by
8.
Yeah.
4 by 8.
Made out of tungsten carbide steel. And yeah, no, they're 12 inches by 18 inches.
Okay, so they would fit in a Mazda 3. Okay.
Yeah. If your snowboard fits in that, these would fit in.
Okay. Can you send me
one of them headed to? One of them headed to Longfellow Drive. So
yeah,
maybe a good.
And the other ones are the bike, no biking at Bear Meadow, and it's going to go at the three kiosks, and those get to Will Finch. But I'll get you in contact with Will.
Okay, so if I can pick those up, what's the next step other than me just at least having them? You know what I mean? So if I get them, that's still good. And then what?
Well, I'm thinking you're just going to take two of them together, sling a rope between them with the holes, and you're going to walk up and down that area like a sandwich board. And drum up.
I'd be
drum
happy
up some
to
conversations. But no, they get dropped off at the DPW department, and from what I'm hearing, I'm going to confirm this, but they're going to install them for us. I'll confirm that. If they're not going to install them for us, we're because they're going to, I'll talk to Chris Cole. He'll be
okay. Fine. So if you want to, or either I'll write it down right now or shoot me an email with the address. I'm out and about pretty much all morning every day. So, I should be able to just swing by and grab them. And then I'll let you know when I get them.
Great. And I think it would just be simply just drop them off at town hall, except for the bike ones, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Just the dumping ones. Okay, great. I'll send you an email tomorrow.
All right, tree policy. Get this quickly. So received some, Chuck had sent a memo that was developed between DPW and Chuck and planning associated with procedures, trying to develop a procedure for how to deal with trees. I think most of you had a chance to review it. John, I know we got comments from you. We got comments from Dave. I tried to consolidate the comments today, and I think I sent it to you, Chuck, but I don't know if I sent it in time. No.
Yeah. So we're gonna rely on your version that you have.
Okay. So were there any other comments, or let me see if I can pull this up and share the screen then.
Yeah,
I had sent something back to Chuck. Was that shared with Mike, Chuck, or should I? Or
share with Mike right now. I'm not. But if Mike puts up what he has, then you could mention what your comments were.
Okay.
Where is it?
So after going on a site visit to the Charles Cemetery, and really meeting the tree warden and understanding where he's coming from and where we are coming from, where Chuck wants us to be coming from. And then after reading this document, I had responded to Chuck that I thought it seemed to be pretty concise and covered a lot of different scenarios and addressed what action would take place. So at the time it seemed to make a lot of sense to me. I think my one question I had to Chuck was, what is Mike, the tree, what's his understanding of the wetlands in the town? Meaning, is he always going to be able to represent us, in a way? I mean, if he's on a property, does he know if there's wetland issues? If not, then how do we kind of get there to make sure, I guess, if there's a question?
Yeah, so I don't know, Mike, if you want to take that, but I would say that, of course, Mike doesn't know what I know about wetlands, and, you could say the same thing about trees. I don't know what Mike knows about trees. So this is the first crack at, trying to get something where we're working out these issues. where trees are and what to do with them, so we have a policy. I would expect that after a couple of months or a year or so, it's going to be like old hat and we'll work together really well. Right now, it's important to have the policy define what the options are in certain situations. It does say on the bottom of the policy that map geo is not to be used as final source for where wetlands are. And you know, that statement may not be enough, but certainly I'm available to Mike if it ever, if he ever needs to find out. I mean, I'm not sure if Mike is walking out into the woods to take down tree. He's mostly in the parks and cemeteries along the road, and when neighbors call about our abutting property. So that helps.
So what was the other commission did the, was the, I'm interested to see what the other, the overall feel was of the document. Was it a good first crack or no?
Mike, is it possible for you to make your screen a bigger so the font size is bigger?
That work?
Mm-hmm.
It didn't change it at all for me. Oh, that's better. Yes.
All right. So I guess what I'll say, Carl, is, you know, I think Chuck said it exactly right. I think this is one of those things that, you know, we develop now and, you know, 5 years from now, you don't even need this, right? It's just going to hopefully this process becomes ingrained in the head of like, okay, yeah, this is the situation. This is, if it's Chuck, you're like, I need to call Mike. If it's Mike, I need to call Chuck. But it at least sets the standard so that each of us can look and say, okay, are we doing what we each thought we were going to be doing? So ultimately, I think it's based on, you know, I think because it's based on having communication and trying to engage that communication, I think this is exactly what I was looking for. Yeah. John, I think these are showing up as my comments, but I put in you had a couple questions in here that ultimately you wanted to have is, you know, what happens if the tree warden and the conservation agent don't agree on the proposed course of action? Now, you know, I think this is one of those things that will ultimately, just like I said. The goal would be that hopefully they do come to, like, this is what we did, this is what the solution was. I think if it goes beyond this, you know, I think it's just going to be, you know, we need to engage more people, like that. We need to engage the chair or the DPW director and see what the right path is and understand why. But I don't know that we're going to be able to cover, every reason or why of disagreement, but I do get that it somewhat leaves an open-ended
right,
case
so
there.
I think what I was kind of trying to get at with that is it seems like we're laying out like all the different possible situations that we can have, whether it's an emergency situation, non-emergency, or in a right of way, or on conservation land, or if it's a tree falling on a private property from conservation land, or falling from a private property onto conservation land, but it's not always clear like whose call it is to deal with these trees. Like, in it seems like the emergency situations is the tree warden, which I guess makes sense, but if it's in the non-emergency ones, kind of conservation commissioner or the conservation minister and the tree warden will talk and they'll figure it out. But I guess it'd be nice to have it kind of spelled out, like whose ultimate call it is.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
So in a situation where this comes up, the one that comes up the most is when a tree is in conservation land close to another property, but also close to a house. A tree that, you know, could possibly fall on the house or fall in the yard. And then this thing sets it up. Is it a danger tree, or is it needs to come down right away, or is it something that doesn't need to come down, but, you know, potentially could fall down in a windstorm? Basically, this document, Mike Hannaford, he has no responsibility as far as taking the tree down because it's not a dangerous tree. But the Conservation Commission could say, we're okay with you taking the tree down, but you're gonna have to pay for it. So I don't know if that helped. I think Mike's options to work with the Conservation Commission are spelled out pretty well, but I think mostly it leads to us hashing out who's gonna, you know, in real time, what's gonna happen with the tree. And usually I really haven't said, hey, that tree shouldn't come down. I have said, when are you gonna replant a new tree? And he refused to talk to me about that. So that's the only conflict that came up.
Should, can I just make a suggestion that, I mean, maybe we could add some sort of wording here that says, if a situation, you know, if an effective solution isn't agreeable to both parties, it goes to the Conservation Commission to be discussed at a meeting. I mean, that's one idea. Another thought I had was it could be something decided between the chair and the administrator. I don't know what exactly would be an appropriate approach, but I like the idea of consensus. I like the idea of if there's any difficulty or uncertainty in a decision, that it goes to the Conservation Commission, especially because it's on our jurisdictional area. So that's my 2 cents on that.
Yeah, I guess, you know, at the end of the day, that's what I read this saying, right? It is, you know, if Chuck and Mike have a conversation and this seems like a very straightforward process and everybody's, they're on the same page, they're going to agree, it's going to get done. If there's not a clear understanding or they disagree, I think that's the point where, well, let's set up a site visit. Let's engage the Conservation Commission. You know, that's the steps that would create that second and third situation. I mean, there may be points when we still say, Chuck still says, hey guys, just so you know, this happened, you should go out and take a look. But
I'm sorry, man. Go ahead, Anika. I was gonna say, I do wanna emphasize that our goal really should be the effective respect and cooperative collaboration between town members, between the tree warden and Chuck. And I think we're getting there, and I think that's one of the good reasons to have this is to make it clear. But I don't want
I mean, I want this to foster a better situation moving forward and better compliance and respect for the laws we're supposed to enforce. It's not like, you know, it's not that we're being arbitrary about resource area. We've got mandates we've got to enforce. So, you know, if we can, I think in some way, maybe if there's disagreement or in a decision, how about you just say as a blanket statement, if there's any disagreement in decision, you know, like it comes for all of these situations, it comes before the conservation commission.
But then I think at that instance, Anika, there has to be criteria that has to be brought into the full commission meeting as to how this is adjudicated between the conservation commission and the tree warden.
Okay.
You know, and it has to be, you know, kind of concrete, you know, biologic, you know, safety, species, etc. You know, I think there has to be a list of criteria.
Yeah, I mean, we're highlighting non-emergency situation.
Right.
So, this is one of those situations.
Right.
You know,
where a list of criteria are developed that are the basis of the discussion that is brought between the tree warden and the conservation commission.
Yeah, I would just caution at trying to figure out every time that there may be where there may be a disagreement. I don't know that we're going to be able to capture that.
Maybe we could put it in as a softer statement, sort of like if there's difficulty in reaching consensus, the Conservation Commission can be advised. I don't know. I mean, you know, but some hint of a fallback, because it is our jurisdiction. I mean, we can't. It's our land that we're responsible for maintaining and protecting and doing the best we can with it. And we clearly don't have enough resources to do that. And it'd be great to get Mike on board with that. But so hopefully this can help.
I guess my question at the end of the day, you know, for this piece is, so we have this last sentence here, and or if the conservation needs to be brought into the conversation, say, is everything we're saying not covered by that?
I tend to agree with Mike that this spells out a process, a good faith process between, you know, members of the community and those who administer the, you know, taking down of trees. I think there's value in not necessarily spelling out an adjudicating process. I mean, I think this is supposed to be, you know, the tree warden working with the Conservation Commission in good faith and setting out a, you know, more clear or a more defined adjudicated process. I don't know if that's really the way we'd want to go. I mean, and to Mike's point, I mean, this language already suggests that we're gonna, you know, the administrator is going to respond and let the tree warden know if they agree or disagree, or if they want to set up, you know, a site walk or bring in the Conservation Commission.
So in most cases that's true, but there's like a line here where when the tree warden determines that it is an emergency, he's going to take the tree down, and then he can do that before he lets the Conservation Commission know, or he lets the administrator know, and you know, maybe that's how it should happen. Because if he's calling something an emergency, then you know, it's gonna be hard to defend that particular tree. I just think of the Charles Lawn Cemetery, and all those trees there were called an emergency. They all needed to come down for safety reasons. And that is a situation where I wouldn't have agreed with. I would have said it's not a safety reason, because you only have to not have the people working underneath them, and that would give the time for the Conservation Commission to review this and then, you know, make a determination, or myself. So I think the definition of what is an emergency needs to be looked at, and then how soon the commission is notified after something's called an emergency, and then what if the process, such as the process usually happens where the tree, if it falls and there's a part in the woods, conservation land, and there's a part in a field or someone's house or someone's lawn, that part on the lawn is processed. Part in the conservation land is not processed. So it's just left there to sit. And in a lot of cases, that's fine. But if it was, in our judgment, too close to a BBW or a stream, or there was just like a depression there that had, that was taking on surface water and it was going to be diverted, maybe we didn't want that. So I was thinking that would be something to make sure that we had the ability to do, to say, yeah, you took away the emergency, but what the place looks like after we're finished, you know, we need to be involved in that process.
Where you can see footnote one here.
Yep.
I think it would be better to change the wording to just say by the conservation administrator, because in all the other things you say the tree warden, and that way 100 years from now it will still apply, even though Chuck won't be with us by then, we presume.
Immortal.
Jeez, well, Chuck.
Well, you could say, don't they say Mike Hannaford, the tree warden? You could say Chuck Tirone, the conservation administrator. No, this is fine.
I think it's Hannaford, the tree warden.
Yeah, it just says there's no Hannaford in there.
Maybe we're still missing a word in there. As determined in the field, if needed, by the conservation commissioner, administrator. Yeah, that's it. Yes, that's right.
So this map GeoPod should be used as a resource. I think that's too strong. I mean, there's a disclaimer on map Geo that says, you know, we won't accept this for permits.
What's that? What's wrong with this?
Well, Map Geo is not going to give you every wetland in town, and it's not going to give you an accurate wetland edge.
Yeah, but so we say that, right? We're saying it should only be used as a resource.
Okay.
Do you think it needs to say something different?
I think if they're going to right, Map Geo, they probably would want to go to us before Map Geo.
Yeah.
Maybe just take that whole sentence out then, and just leave as determined in the field by the conservation administrator.
Where'd this footnote now come from? Here it is.
Right at the top.
I'm fine with that. We know it's a resource. people know it's a resource. Well, ultimately, this first sentence is the important piece. All right. So, Chuck, I think to your point, I think what we need here, right, is a sentence saying that the we're not going to need wordsmithing tonight, but ultimately, what I'd like to get in there, Chuck, to your point, is this deals with how to eliminate the risk, that there's a right to eliminate the risk, but ultimately, what we need in here is something that says, like, you will still be contacted, and that the final condition of the site needs to have some sort of approval. Yeah, maybe there's this dire emergency that something is coming down and there needs to be a reaction. But that doesn't mean that, like, there's everything just walks away and you're never consulted, that you don't have the ability to say, no, don't take any more of that or leave the rest of the stump now that you've eliminated the risk. So I think what I'd like to try to get in here is some sort of sentence associated with, like, after that risk is eliminated, like, that coordination, you know, you need to go back to the coordination that's performed during non-emergency hours, non-emergency situations.
That sounds like the kind of wording that they give when you are going to the hospital emergency room and you have to notify your insurance company within 48 hours of going to the emergency room. So maybe that same sort of, the conservation administrator should be notified of the situation within 48 hours or within 2 business days or something like that.
Yeah, I would like it to be quick. I mean, and I think I would like to make sure it's quicker than that, 48 hours.
Next business day? By the next business day, maybe?
As soon as practically possible.
So Mike has to write a report on each tree. I mean, this is my understanding. He has to write a report on trees that he evaluates. So he's doing this anyways. So he would just have to
on the report. And we say as soon as possible here.
Is that too open?
No, I don't want to dwell on the words too much. I certainly want to be careful because this is certainly setting the policy, but ultimately, you know, in my opinion, if there's a situation, you know, from the standpoint of the Conservation Commission, what are the risks? If Mike all of a sudden started going around, and whether it was Mike, but the tree warden all of a sudden started going around and saying, every tree is an emergency, I've got full authority to take necessary and immediate action on all of those. I think at the end of the day, there's a reporting requirement to this, and I think there's a communication requirement to this, that if we see that being abused after the fact, you know, we're gonna have to be, no, like, these are not emergencies, these are not qualifying as what we think is an emergency, and at least now that we're forcing the communication, the Conservation Commission, whether it's this commission or some commission in the future, is going to have the ability to say, you know, you're abusing that bullet point if it gets to that, because there's this reporting aspect. And so with that, I guess I'm fine with the language we have. I do want to add something here associated with after the fact, but I think because there's a reporting requirement, I think there's a level of checks and balances that we're getting that maybe we didn't have before, because some of these happened and we just had no idea.
Maybe instead of fill in the blank at the end, right after mm-hmm. where you've got highlighted that says as soon as possible, if you just add the one word notwithstanding, comma, the tree warden shall have full authority. So, or nevertheless, or a word like that, you know, meaning that he's notifying the conservation administrator as soon as possible, but nevertheless, he can take it down if he absolutely has to.
Was this, so this in blue, one of the commissioners wrote?
I did.
Dave.
I wrote that.
Yeah, I don't think you want to change. That's change. A big change, Dave.
Change what?
I might be reading it wrong, but
I don't know what you're referring to, because I can't see it.
Oh.
I have no idea what you're referring to.
So you wrote in, the tree warden shall have the full authority necessary, and I just lost it.
Sorry, I'm pulling up an old one to see if it was. No, it said that before.
Okay.
I thought it said something like that before. I think Dave, I don't know how to get this off, sorry. I don't think Dave made, you know, that's what I thought when I looked at this earlier. I don't think Dave made a big change here. I think he made it specific to the tree and just did the he, she, right? Ultimately, this says the same thing, though.
The biggest thing that I had to change in the beginning of this was to kind of delineate what jurisdictional parameters were, kind of as under the first footnote. Instead of saying within the 200-foot or 100-foot of the riparian zone or whatever, is to kind of just categorize that as wetland areas or whatever, and put that under a footnote, because it just that kind of sounded awkward to me. But you know, the rest of the stuff I think I did was really just kind of changing words and grammar, not really the substance of the document.
All right. Well, we're approaching 11 o'clock here.
Worked on. At least look at a little bit more. And
so let me do this. So I think I had combined what we had here. So John, let me just, maybe we can address your one more comment here. All right, it's basically the same thing. Let me see if I can, based on these comments, and what we just talked about, make some more edits, and I'll send it right back to the group, and hopefully we can resolve this soon. But I don't think we're never going to get the wording at 10:55 at night, the wording the way we want it to be. So does that make sense to everybody?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes.
At least we're not driving home at 10:55 at night.
All right. Are there any
that
other?
That sounds like a good plan. I'll send out.
Are there any other items?
I was just going to say I'll send out the order for Smith Oil, Main Street project, tomorrow or Friday, and
Yeah, if you send me the changes, Mike, I can send them out to the commissioner. You can send them out to the commission on the tree policy.
Okay.
And so it might be interesting to review, if anyone watched the last select board meeting, there was talk about a tree policy with the DPW department that was just formalized with the select board. Maybe be interested to you know, look at that also.
Chuck, so I'll keep it quick, but yes, so everybody knows, last night I attended the select board meeting and gave some background onto the 1447 Main Street project, because Mr. Poirier has gone to the select board in requesting, you know, essentially some money or for the project. So they wanted to have some background. But within that, as Chuck was saying, there was some discussion that the town has developed a policy, and maybe I missed this part. You know, did they talk about the policy or approve the policy, Chuck, or did they just mention it?
They mentioned it. They didn't
yeah.
give any details, but they did say the policy with the DPW department. And
there's a policy that exists, apparently, mm-hmm. associated with trees. So. Be interested to see what that is. Ultimately, one of the things that came from that was they would like to try to get a policy that covers whether it's conservation land or town land or things outside of necessarily we as a commission have a policy within jurisdictional area, but have never really applied that outside that area. So, but apparently there is a town policy that has been approved. So. Any other items?
Seems like it.
I'm hearing none.
Time to go to bed.
Motion to adjourn?
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Oh my God. Must be tired. All right. See you later, everyone.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Good night.
Okie dokie.